Select Board of March 27th.
Don't worry.
First thing on the agenda, actually, something we forgot to do last week, and that is to elect a chair of this board. So I know I carried on as if, you know, that was the best.
And then we nominate Suzanne Hewitt to be the chair of the Select Board for 2017 and 2018.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much for your. Thank you. We'll stop it there. Approval of minutes. Any questions or comments on the minutes of March 20th? It was a regular board meeting. Ready to approve by consensus? Okay, so approved. Community input. We're going to just check to see if there's community input. Otherwise, did I see Jeff? Was Jeff just around?
He was here a minute ago.
All right, because we want him here for the discussion with Mike. Here he is. Okay. But first, let me check with community input. Please.
Hi there. Lorraine Hanson, Watson Lane. I'm here on behalf of the library trustees, the Rollinsford Public Library, to our chagrin, Tony House, who was elected, has resigned. We regretfully accepted her resignation at our last board meeting, and at which time the trustees voted in favor of having Tamara Lisakowski join our board of trustees. So that was, I'm here to ask that, since we recommended her, that this board appoint her.
I think there's a letter also. I think I saw one today from.
Yes, I think there's a letter from
Liz
Marcotte.
Liz Marcotte. Is it in your? So we have the
last week.
We have the recommendation of the trustees.
Mm-hmm.
So
when did Tony resign?
When did Tony resign?
Huh?
When did Tony resign?
Right, just before our meeting, a couple days before our meeting.
When was your meeting?
Monday. Last Monday.
Tuesday.
Okay.
Last Tuesday.
Yeah,
last Tuesday, okay.
Okay, so the person that we put in as an alternate
was able to fill in at the last meeting, and then
move her up, and then Tamara as an alternate.
No, Emily decided that she would remain as an alternate.
Okay, well, this hasn't gone out for because now we're back into the same situation as appointing somebody. Put it out to public notice if anybody else would want it.
Well,
because
it's
we're
not,
going for the transparency, right? Remember?
Yes, but we haven't. This is not unlike what we've done with the Planning Board, the Conservation Commission. I mean, we have been listening to the chair's nominations.
Okay, but when the Budget Committee did it, they got chastised for not putting out. Putting
budget
out
committee
there.
Is elected.
So is a trustee.
But the Board of Trustees are independent from.
So that's an interesting point. Can the board actually appoint the trustee themselves? Because that's what the budget committee. We don't appoint budget committee members.
Excuse me. Under the law, we are allowed to recommend, and under 202, I forget the number, the Board of Selectmen will then appoint. This has been what you've done with the Conservation Commission.
Yes.
And all the other commissions.
It's different from the Budget Committee. The Budget Committee gets to appoint their own vacancies.
Right, but then they get chastised for it. So for open transparency, shouldn't we put it out there that there is an opening? Wait 1 week. So we have that open transparency, so no one has that argument later saying, you know, why did I not know about it? I would have taken that position. You know what I mean?
I understand. And I also agree that we're not consistent. I mean, we've been accepting the recommendations of the Planning Board. You know, Al is going to give us recommendations for the Conservation Commission. So, but nonetheless.
Right, but they're not elected.
Pardon?
Can I just speak on this for just 1 second?
Yeah.
I think it would probably behoove all of you to check in with the Library Trustees Association on how this is supposed to be handled because of that interesting relationship between the Board of Selectmen and Library Trustees.
It's true that there is.
Because it is not the same as all of the other boards and commissions.
That's correct.
Yeah.
And the laws are very clear that apply to their jurisdiction.
And that we appoint if there is an opening, which we just found out about this morning.
No,
they emailed us this morning.
Right, but I think.
Right, the Carol.
I think Caroline had the email, she forwarded to us.
Okay, once again, I just found out this morning.
So we want to hold off a week?
Yeah, we can find.
Why can't we hold off?
Yes, we'll.
Put something in the newspaper, not the newspaper, the website, you know, is anybody else interested?
We can check, and in the meantime, we'll also check with the municipal associations.
But you will also have to have that person go through the trustees voting for that person.
That's right. We have to make that recommendation again. We've already made a recommendation. We could pick anybody.
But you didn't put it out there for it to be asked, just like school board. There was a vacancy on the school board, right? It's not this year, but.
I'm only talking about library trustees. The library trustees.
But I'm trying to create as transparent as we can, so we don't hear later on the cronies and the my friends and your friends. Let's just do it as open and as free as possible.
But it has to be within the law. It has to be within the rules. So, you know, you're making a fine point, but you have to be within the rules. And part of the problem with the inconsistency and the, you know, the my friend, your friend thing, for decades, people didn't follow the rules. And what I appreciate about your board is that you are trying to follow the rules, but you have to know what they are, and then you have to follow what they are.
Oh, and I know what they are.
I don't think you know what the library trustee rules are. Have you read the library trustee's manual?
I just read Knowing Your Territory before I got here, and it said we appoint.
But did you read the library
trustee's
manual?
There are special RSAs.
Yes, they are.
Right. And the fact of the matter is, in the past.
So you're not willing to look at anybody else's recommendations if they're interested?
We're saying that in the past, this was what was done on this committee when there had been prior openings. And we've done it the same way. We're asking if you recommend it. If someone else wants to come before the Board of Trustees, and we will consider them and make a recommendation.
How would they know?
But we generally speaking would not be, excuse me?
How would they know?
Liz has something.
How would they know?
Excuse me, Liz?
How would they know?
Oh, wait a minute.
How would they know?
They would know if we were looking out for someone. And in the past, no.
And how would you put that information out there?
It was a long time for us to even get someone to run before.
Oh, I hear ya. I totally hear ya.
I am gonna, Liz is a former trustee, I believe.
Yes, she's asked.
So.
I will say that I sent a letter to the board, which hopefully you received.
You did.
Yep, and it's my understanding, that when letters are received, they're read into the record. In response to your question, Joni, about how would they know, I think if there were people who were interested in the library, like friends of the library, of which we have many, people who frequented the library, people who came to the trustees meeting and showed interest, then they would know that the library was looking for someone. And
so you just found out on Tuesday, though. I haven't seen anything on the website.
It amazes me that there seems to be a challenge in how things have been done when they're done according to the library RSAs as documented in the materials. And we have never had people come forth before. I don't know if you know someone else who's interested in being a trustee, but I can tell you that this is how it's done in other libraries, as documented by the library materials. And we would look for someone who, number one, would be an advocate for the library and be a supporter for the library, not someone who had concerns about where the money goes at the library or who gets a big fat raise or whatever. We would want someone who had the library's best interests at heart. And I then would circle back to thinking that someone like that would be someone who already was involved in the foundation and building of the library, involved through coming to library events, involved in being a library member.
But I will totally agree with
there's
you.
There's a simple answer to your question, Joni, about where it would be posted. Well,
Tamara, please.
I will totally agree with you that there will probably be nobody that comes forward. my whole point is that we're trying to create this open
transparency. Yeah.
I totally get it. And I don't want one group chastising another group. We're trying to bring this community together. That's all I'm asking is to wait 1 week, put it out there.
How do you propose putting it out there?
Put it
on the website that we're looking for trustees?
Put it on the website. Post it like we're supposed to post things.
It's supposed to be posted? That's in the RSAs? I don't believe so.
Can I?
I'll stop so you can, I want to respect the board and the process.
Thank you, I appreciate it. So, there are various levels of commissions and boards and committees and advisories, this and that. And the library trustees, as the cemetery trustees, do operate under some very specific RSAs that are, you know, they're in a manual, it's kind of yay thick. I mean, I know I've seen it and I've seen parts of it, but I'm not up to date on it. So it is possible, maybe even likely, that the mechanism that we are now part of is entirely proposed and fine, even though it may not be how we would want to do it for our other boards and commissions and committees. So I don't know the answer to that. I mean, I can go back and check in with the powers that be, with the AG, whoever manages the library trustees, to check on this process. You know, we can ask if the board wants to see if anybody out there is interested. I don't want to tell, you know, again, I don't think we have the authority to tell the trustees what to do. They're not like an advisory committee to us.
Mm-hmm. I would just like to add that when I stepped down as a trustee, because I wasn't going to be here for a couple of months, and I thought the library needs trustees who were there all the time and not doing, I hear about some committees that people do Skyping to attend meetings. I think you need to be there. You need to be in the library. Well, when I stepped down and I came before the board and I tendered my resignation, and at that time made the recommendation that Lorraine be appointed, and no one else that I know of has ever come forward and said, gee, I'm interested in being a library trustee. We can hardly get people to be friends of the library and support. So it is how we did it last time, and I think it's in the best interest of the library. And I don't know anyone else besides Tamara who has said, gee, I really want to go down there and volunteer in this sometimes thankless role in this town, in this community. But it is how it was done last time, and that was...
And it wasn't so close to election. We're a week away from that.
It's unfortunate. I thought about that.
Yeah.
I was thinking that there have been people who have died after they signed up to run and got elected, and not here, but this
right.
happened in the
exactly.
community.
Exactly.
So, right.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm just trying to think, and again, as someone who's painted walls and washed windows and got the furniture for down there and who's been very committed to the library, that you have my letter, and if you want to read it into the record, which my understanding is if letters are received, that's what happened, that Tamara's interested, she's
yeah.
a hard worker, she's
they
got
are.
The best interest of the library at heart.
They already read it in the record.
Oh, I apologize.
We'll attach it. I mean, I'm happy to read it out loud if you would request
and
so
we'll put it
on
the
so dear Selectmen, as a community member, and then Michael will continue. Question. As a community member who contributed to the creation of a public library for our town, a longstanding member of the Friends of the Rollinsford Public Library, and a former library trustee, I would like to recommend that the Rollinsford Select Board approve the appointment of Tamara Nijakowski as library trustee. Tamara has consistently demonstrated her passion for the library and has supported the library through her volunteer work for the library, her previous role as librarian, and foremost, Tamara has always acted in the best interest of the library. The primary responsibility of a library trustee, as cited by the New Hampshire Library Trustee Association, is to be an advocate for a library. Tamara has always been a very public advocate for the library, and serving as a trustee will no doubt continue to be an enthusiastic advocate for our library, and in turn, continue to help build our community. Sincerely, Elizabeth Marco. All right, Michael,
I'm sorry.
You are wanting to say
yes.
something.
Okay, so RSA 202A:10, Library Trustees, Vacancies, Alternates. Vacancies occurring on any Board of Library Trustees in the town shall be filled as provided in RSA 669:75, which I'll read you in a moment. A vacancy occurring among the public elected members of the Board of Library Trustees of a city library shall be filled by the City Council or appropriate appointing authority within 2 months of the notice by the remaining members of the Board of Trustees. That doesn't pertain. The Board of Library Trustees may recommend to the appointing authority names of persons for appointing to vacancies and expired terms. Board of Library Trustees may recommend to the appointing authority the names of no more than three persons who may serve as alternate members on the board when elected members of the board are unable to attend a board meeting. The alternate member shall be appointed for 1 year. So how do you fill it? You go to RSA 669:75, which reads, vacancies in the office of RSA 669:75, vacancies in other offices. Vacancies in the offices of constable, sewer commissioner, town assessor, overseers of public welfare, library trustee, and any other optional offices where no other method of filling a vacancy shall be provided, this is the case, shall be provided by a vote of the town, shall be filled by the appointment made by the Board of Selectmen. So we are, they just make a recommendation, we are the appointing authority. We don't have to follow the recommendation, foolish, I would think, not to follow the Board of Library Trustees, but that's just outside. So if it's in the best interest of the community, I would say we can put out on the website, there's a vacancy on the Library Trustee Board, Board of Library Trustees. If anyone is interested, please let us know by Monday evening at 6:30 p.m. in writing to be considered. And if anyone is, comes forward, we consider them at that time. If not, then we just, we can consider the nomination by the Library Trustees. But we're not, according to the statute, under any obligation to forward the Library Trustees' recommendation. I'm happy to move on it tonight if you want to. I'm happy to follow their recommendation. But if we want to wait another week, I don't think the sky will fall.
Just one thing I want to say. It's not like we're it's not like you're hiring someone where you have to open it up and post it. This is a completely different situation. And as I say, we were looking at different people who would be showing an interest in the library. We were lucky when we found someone who said that they were interested. We were thrilled when Tony said she would run and she had been serving. We were devastated when we found out that she was not going to be serving. And believe you me, that was a shock to us all. So we were scrambling, and as I say, luckily, we found that Tamara was willing to serve. And this would be a big boon to the library trustees to have someone who is so committed to the library. We always want to have someone who's committed. That's not always been the case.
When is your next meeting, Lorraine?
Our next meeting is April 11th.
So I would suggest, in the interest of governance, transparent governance, we just put out a little thing on the website. It says, are you interested? Contact the library trustees. Do you have an email? Is there a group email that they can respond to you? Or?
Well, I suppose they could respond to the Rollinsburg.
They could, yeah, they could contact the library.
Yeah.
And
can I ask another question, though? Because if you're saying week, are you precluding the trustees from being able to put their vote of approval on anyone who steps forward? Because they're not meeting again until the 11th, so they would have to have a meeting of their board to review that. So it, your logic in your time frame doesn't really make sense.
We don't have to act on it. They can respond to us within a week and can forward them on to the trustees if that's easy. If they don't have a single email.
But you're pushing this out a month, and the training for the library trustees is coming right up, and I had intended to attend
is
that. I've never been to that before. I wanted to join the trustees association so that I could be on the listserv and begin to participate in that. So you're putting the whole process off for basically a month. Then another week, because we have to come back and get your approval at that point.
Is it possible for you to call a special meeting if we put something out on the website tomorrow, a special meeting of the trustees?
I suppose we can, and you want us to do that assuming you get an answer.
Yes, if we get any interest.
If there's an interest that, in other words, if we were to put it on the library website,
yes.
If there's interest,
yes.
Then
the
we
town
would call it. By next Monday, we would try to call a special meeting and look at it.
Yes.
By Friday.
Or by Friday.
Yeah, you get any interest by Friday, and then you can call a special meeting.
And then we'll call a special meeting that we could have at that point, and then immediately come back here, and then have a recommendation
yes.
come back to you.
Yes.
Could you? We can send a blast on the town email address.
Yeah, we can do
well,
it.
But, so they have to be in by Friday by close of business. And then you all have a special meeting on Monday evening at 6. Make
your
recommendation to us and
we'll
hear at 6:30.
Just before this.
Yeah.
I mean, if there's no interest, then you can just send us an email and say,
So, can I ask one other question? When is the registration deadline for the trustees training?
I don't have the paperwork with me.
It's pretty soon because it's coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Is it coming up in the next week or two?
It's probably. We're trying to.
It's in April, I don't remember the date.
Yeah, I can't remember exactly the date, but I know it's like we want to register so that we can get there for, like, the first and second of April.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
I think we have a plan.
We have a plan, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, guys.
Okay. Any other community input? I think we're ready to talk about salt and General Sullivan. Mike, if you want to come up. Jeff is here. Mike, do you know all of us? You know Jody?
I know the names.
Yes, Jody Carnes, Mike Rolo.
Nice to see you again. Thank you again.
Just so everyone knows, this is Mike Trank, who's a consulting engineer. Do I have that correct for the Water District Commission?
Right. So really, I'm here on behalf of the Water and Sewer District. As your mayor might be aware, they have been in the process of replacing the General Sullivan well, one of the two public water supplies for Rollinsford. And for a public water supply well, there's a 400-foot protected radius around the well. And as part of this ongoing, as part of this replacement project, the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services has asked us to look at a number of things. One of those is acquiring easements where it's possible, and we're actually doing that in one case. And on other properties that are already developed, we've developed mailers that went out with information, such as, you know, not putting oil in, soil and ground, having septic systems.
Sounds like stormwater management stuff.
So, yeah, there's a lot of similarity. But one of the other things they asked us to look at was potentially having a low salt use area. So that, the 400-foot protected radius encompasses roughly about 712 linear feet on General Sullivan Way.
Thank you.
Is there, Jeff, would you like, why don't you come up and take a look at this? Unless, is there one for Jeff?
Mm-hmm.
So, pursuant to that request from DES, I sent that letter to Suzanne asking if the select board would give consideration to approving a low salt use area.
Or this yellowed piece of roadway, is that
correct? Correct, and the highlighted piece. The sewer district said that they would pay for signage and have that installed.
So if it says most.
But because it's a public road, it does require the approval.
Sure. So Jeff, would you like to ask a question, or do you know what it means? So it means we can't put down salt in that area, is that?
Well, I anticipated you were going to ask me that. So I did bring some information, which I'm happy to share quite a bit, actually. This is actually on the New Hampshire DES. That's information. It's actually on the website.
Thank you.
No salt usage. This one is from Wisconsin Transportation Bulletin. Out of the Road Management Journal, talking about options for reducing salt usage.
Okay.
by the de-icing chemical truck before?
No.
Probably not. Well, that's the thing. You can pull stuff from the web that bigger municipalities have access to.
Right.
Yeah. You were not apples to apples.
This was an article that I found trying to, they call it a low salt diet. Just some suggestions for consideration. Obviously, you're not under any obligation to do this.
To issue a low salt area, is that?
Right. The whole point would be that it's part of the protection of the water supply.
Sure, I would say that we would be motivated to try to.
Yeah, protection of the well.
To try to keep the well, so.
Yeah.
So again, I understand that there are other options for us to consider, but for right now, where our primary, I guess, only source of cutting down on icing is salt. So what does that suggest for this area, that we don't put any salt down? Is that what you're anticipating or hoping?
Probably lower, a lesser quantity.
A lesser quantity, yeah. Okay. And Jeff?
Not a problem.
Who does this route?
We all do it. Depends.
Depends on. So you would train or educate or otherwise?
Yeah, what we have to do is put signs up on both ends.
Okay.
Where the low salt is, and we're also going to need signs saying where low salt ends. So there's going to be a total of 4 signs that are going to be purchased and put up.
And that you guys will do?
Right, the district will.
Okay.
All right. And Jeff, is there any sloping areas that, you know, when you get the runoff, that right in that area, that you can think
of? No, we just have a lot of canopy cover, so it's, it'll be an area where we're going to have to.
So maybe we should trim back the trees this year on that.
Canopy over the road, so we're going to have to spend some time.
Yeah.
And so the sun can get to that part of the road.
Do you use sand as well?
No, nope. Mm-hmm. Straight sand.
We used to. We used to use a mixture, I think. And we stopped about 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah, it's actually not really recommended practice anymore.
Exactly.
One or the other.
Right. So we've cut down on street sweeping as a result.
Mm.
So.
Storm.
Yeah.
So lower salt. Remove the canopy.
Signage.
Which the water district is.
Yeah, well, the water department would be helping to pay to help the tree.
I can bring that back to them. I can't speak for them, but I can bring it back.
Yeah, because,
And then we have non-compliant residents.
Well, is it notification enough to have those signs?
Yeah,
well, they're going to wonder why all the trees are being cut all of a sudden in just that one area.
It's not the trees, it's the canopy.
Well, yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah. People look for trees in that area, so.
Yeah, well, sure.
Just a notice that General Sullivan
yes.
will be.
Yeah, yeah, we can put out. Yeah. So, first we have to decide that we're going to do this.
Sorry. Car before the horses.
So, yeah, we can do the low salt. But my only concern is if we start getting hot pack and ice, you know, what do we do at that point in time for the safety of the public? Do we treat it like we normally do to bring a road back to where we need
yeah,
to?
Yeah, it's an issue. Yeah, and you might have to do that.
I think in emergency situations that you're over the long haul, you're doing a low salt. So
we put less salt than what is actually, I guess, which. I guess we go by the state guidelines. Mm-hmm. We actually put less than what the state actually puts down for the lane mile. So, but we can cut it back a notch into that area.
And we have a calibration, you
yeah.
know, that we bought. So, okay. Well, are there other questions or comments, or do we think we're ready to act on this tonight while Mike is here and can bring it back to the water district?
Yeah, we can discuss the canopy
yes.
issue
yeah.
separately. So. I'm fine.
Well, I will entertain a motion then to designate this 400, is it 400 feet of roadway? It's 400 feet of roadway.
It's about 712.
Okay, about 712 feet of roadway.
Do we know?
I don't know the house numbers, but
right.
we'll figure it out.
Well, do you have an electronic version of this?
Mm-hmm.
Could you send that to me?
Sure, good.
Thank you, because then we could post that on the website.
Sure.
Send that to you.
Yes.
Okay.
this, because I most assuredly will lose all of this.
Not a problem. So I can say that anything that I can look at it.
I'm trying to figure what the house is actually going to be.
Well,
how to phrase it.
So is it like 350 feet on each side of the well?
Basically, it's a function of how the 400-foot protected radius falls. So to answer your question, it is centered on the well, but it's not, it may not necessarily, it's, well, actually it's probably 350 feet.
Yeah.
Geometry.
Yes. This is a chord, right? Is this a chord? What do you call a circle? When something goes from one end of the circumference to the other, that's a chord, isn't it? Thank you. It's been a long time ago.
Geometry.
Yes. All right, so how long is this chord? Was that 712?
That's the
okay.
Correct.
That's not lane miles, that's the actual,
that's exactly
the actual chord. Okay. So, once again, I'll entertain. Are you wanting to anchor it by the house numbers? Is that why you're hesitant?
I would just say 350 on each side of the well and sound like 350.
Well, the number of new houses, that's not the point of the motion right now.
It's to generate a low salt area.
Low salt area for the
and
well.
And we've got it identified here. We can post this.
We don't want to identify it strictly where the
zone not,
begins and where it ends.
Well, it doesn't end at someone's house, I don't think. It's a...
Then perhaps you should use lot numbers then. You should designate it, right? You can't just say willy-nilly. Part of General Sullivan John Way is going to be low salt area.
Well, per this diagram.
Fine, you do it. Just do it. Make them all. It's silly to me to do it that way, but that's fine. Go ahead.
You could say within the 400-foot protected radius of the lot.
Yes, definitely. We need a definite area. We can't just say.
Yes, Michael. Are you thinking that we won't have this in the minutes and this can't be referred to? I mean, this is a pretty specific diagram.
Okay.
Yeah, but I'm not going to be able to put that in the minutes.
So.
Well, how do we solve this enigma? How do we solve this conundrum? So that
I can look up the
lot
numbers later. That's what you want.
Okay, so we could do it this way perhaps. We could move to accept the low salt area within the 400-foot protective well radius of the General Sullivan Way well, equaling 712 linear feet within the circumference of the protective radius.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And Caroline, could you find where this, the map, it's not
yes.
precisely congruent with someone's lot, it just falls within someone's lot. If you could
approximate which lots it starts
yes.
and ends at, yes.
Then we can put that in the PR.
Yes, there's a couple of
them.
Yeah. My reasoning is, we all won't be sitting here. And for decades, people did things in a way where it seemed to make sense, but there was no exact record kept in some cases. And they just said, oh, well, we'll designate this and that. I mean, and so we have, how many times have we tried to find things? We don't even know what all of the rights of way are on all of our roads because, well, they weren't always recorded. So, I mean, I'd like to do things as thoroughly as we can. So,
Michael, what I'm suggesting, this is going to go on the web, this is going to Google Drive, it will be filed with all of these things,
yeah.
There will be a record,
okay.
And we'll find out what the lots are. So.
And you want the lot numbers in?
Because it doesn't start at somebody's lot, it's just within someone's lot. So even that definition is not as precise, actually, as this particular. I think we're there though, Mike. So,
I believe there was a question.
May I ask you a question?
Yes.
Are you going to do anything about pesticides in that well protection area? Like use of Roundup and all?
I believe that it was recommended that they at least not be disposed of in the ground. And I'd have to check on the usage, but certainly no disposal to the ground that could, you know, infiltrate the groundwater.
So you'll bring back a question about the canopy and see what the water district says. Do we have a vote? We did vote, so we voted to make this a low salt area. I think we had a question last week too about knowing that you were coming about other areas. And someone mentioned the low-lying area around the Legion, between the Legion and the outfall there. That are there other spots around town that you think might benefit from being low salt? I think it's just a general question. I don't mean to put you in the spot.
To water supply, relative to water quality, possibly.
I mean, as far as outfall into the Salmon Falls River?
But the Porter Well is the other supply, and that's actually on top of the hill. And those are bedrock wells. It's up on the hill.
So we would address that then as we would address stormwater?
I would say so.
Thank you. Are there any questions or comments for Mike?
Not for that, but I got a need in my folder. I haven't read through it yet, but since you're right here, I think you could ask. Wetlands permit application.
This has to do with our culprits, though. This isn't.
Okay, good.
Yeah, this isn't Mike's bailing. I think we're good, Mike.
Okay.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much,
Mike.
Mike.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Jeff, you're still on. If there are things that you would like to.
I have a couple.
Purchase order 1170 with Pro Technologies for the alarm services of the highway department for a sum of $239.40.
Move to accept purchase order 1170 to Pro Technologies for alarm services for 1 year for $239.40.
Second. This is just our annual,
it's just the annual
payment for.
What is it called?
It's a highway shed repairs and maintenance.
Okay. All right, so this is something we do every year.
I've never made a purchase order up for it. This is the first time I've ever.
Oh, well, thank you for doing that. That's why it seems maybe that we're not quite so familiar. Excellent. Very good. You are to be commended. So I have a motion and a second. Any other questions or comments on this? All those in favor say aye.
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 Pro Technologies.
The same company that we have our town hall. Yes. Part of our separate set.
I'm not sure. You
just carry
on the line. Why? So this company that we're using for the town hall security, it's the same one we use for, for the highway department, it's the same one we use for town hall and
yes.
Fire? And
no fire.
It's not just one. Okay, not
fire pump doesn't assist them.
It's not just one. That's why I'm not surprised. It's not just one bill?
No, they sent two bills because two different buildings.
Right.
And the highway department was added years after we had the
okay.
It established in this building.
Okay.
Not that it's not a bad idea someday to try to.
I was just wondering why we've never, none of us remember ever seeing one before.
It's the 27th early this morning, and guess what?
It is still.
Purchase order number 941 for Rochester Truck, and it's for two LED lights for the GNC top kit for $83.14.
Purchase order number 0941 for Rochester Truck for two LED work lights for the GNC top kit for $83.14.
Second.
This is something you couldn't use the credit card
for? These were bought a while ago, and I think they got mixed up in there.
And first and second.
You guys say the kerfuffle.
Yeah, kerfuffle.
Yeah, that would be.
Yeah. All right, we'll let it go and just say all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. In the future, though, might this be something you could use a credit card?
Absolutely.
And Carolyn, did you put the credit card?
It's in the
Yeah, that, yes.
Purchase order 942 to Allied Equipment, and it's for a spring extension tensioner for the wing of the GMC Claw kit for $122.36.
Can we just buy that last
one? Nope, that was for my truck.
The springs. Move to accept purchase order 942 to Allied Equipment for one spring extension for two GMC Tough Kick wings for a total of $122.36.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Purchase order 943 to Pike Industries for 2.25 ton of coal patch for $296.72.
Here comes spring.
I move purchase order 0943 to Pike Industries for 2.25 ton of coal patch for $296.72.
Second.
Any discussion?
So part of that coal patch will be used on Oak Street, I'm guessing. There's a couple of sizable pumble there.
That coal patch went I've
already used it. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
So, well, are you aware of the other, there's two potholes closer to Rollins or Highland Ave and of by the junction there.
Okay.
So I don't know if that's our problem or if that's Dover. So that's part of the MOU for winter, I think, so I don't know. But so you're aware. If not your problem, then Dover needs to fix it.
All right. Any other discussions? All those in favor say aye.
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 Last but not least, uniforms for the transfer station and highway department. Went out and got three quotes. One was General Linen, one was G&K, and one was Universe. General Linen came in at $2,556.84 for the year. They require a 60-month contract with a 5% yearly increase. G&K came in at $2,860 a year, and they require a 3-year contract with a 5% increase every year. And Universe came in at $1,650.48 a year, and they also require a 5-year contract, but they also stipulated that if funds were not available, that they would waive, and they increased 3% a year.
So that's the lowest, right?
Yeah.
Unless I wasn't listening correctly.
Yes. So I have a purchase order, 944, $1,650.48 to UniFirst.
Now, is that include the cleaning? Or is this?
That's included, so it's 39 shirts, 39 pants, and 10 jackets.
Okay.
So they're going to cover?
Myself, my part-time guy, and the three guys at the transfer station.
That was part of joint loss.
Yes.
All
and
the stuff
also
that needs to be
part
signed
of our budget.
Correct. Is highlighted. And it's the purchase order. I don't know who wants the purchase order.
So it's not just the uniforms, it's the cleaning of the uniforms.
Yeah, they come
yeah.
by once a week
yeah.
and they'll pick the uniforms up each every Tuesday and they'll leave new uniforms.
Okay.
The clothes we will be getting, it's about a 3 or 4 week cycle time before we receive the uniforms. They're actually going to order all new uniforms for us. So we'll start out with all brand new clothing. And as they get ripped and destroyed and damaged, they will be replaced as they.
So where is this company? Is it UniFirst? Where are they? And why are they so, why do they come in Manchester?
I think they're out of Portland and they have a company in Manchester area, national.
I mean, there's a difference.
I'm not sure, to be honest with you. I do
know
that a lot of other businesses in the area use them.
So it could just be that we're a small stop for them and part of a route that they already have.
Yeah, like they do Atlantic, they do Clearwater, they do C&J.
So maybe it was just
very
simple
area,
for them.
They
do
like,
Dover.
No, G&K
does. To Dover.
They do, I believe, Summersworth. They do like everybody in this area, so just maybe part of their run.
So in a couple of weeks, we'll see you coming in Rollinsford. insurance.
I'll probably be coming in there for my wellness insurance, I'll probably be carrying it in there.
Oh, that's right.
So, so this, the board gave an allowance of $300 a year for sweatshirts. And so do you want to take that money and buy sweatshirts for the guys? Or do we want to, I'm just wondering how the board wants to take that money. I know we use it for, right now we're using it for sweatshirts and shirts, t-shirts, but the t-shirts will be taken care of by the regular shirts that we're going to get. And then the sweatshirts, I don't know, but they want to leave it in there for you to buy shirts with the town logo on it, or what they want to do.
I'm asking a question that could have been asked before, I guess. Where are they changing? They have put their uniforms on when they get to work and then leave them there, right?
Right in the bathroom.
In the bathroom of the highway department?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there'll be a laundry bag in there where
okay. We may have already covered that. We probably already did, so I apologize.
What line is it
going to
come out?
You should have
uniform
the
line.
Uniforms 232.
350 in that. I thought we had 3,000.
There's 3,000.
Yeah, you put it all.
Look at the transfer station.
You put it all in the transfer station.
In the transfer station.
Sorry.
That's okay. So if you look at the transfer station, it is uniform / cleaning. It has $3,000.
Oh yes.
Okay. And now your question. Now that I've got this over, so please repeat your question about.
So the highway department has $350 a year
for uniforms.
For uniforms. Now, does the town want to delete that line? Or does the town still not going to be able to buy sweatshirts or jackets, I guess, like safety jackets?
Well, you know, I don't want to answer for the entire board, but because a line exists, it's not an obligation to spend it. So if there were a need during the year, then we would consider it to come out of that line. If there's no need to, please don't feel compelled to spend up that line. We're always happy to move the money to another line that might be looking for some help or assistance. I don't know if I've answered the question, but the board would like to say something different.
Are you in need of those items at the moment for the highway department?
Everybody has at least two sweatshirts that works at the highway department. But I just didn't know if the town wanted to continue doing that, or if you wanted to just...
Well, we could next year, when we're doing our budget, we could have this conversation again and just see if we want to keep that line or how we want to do it.
Yeah, when we're ready, like mid-season,
you could have some new person. Yeah. So we'll keep the line for this year, and if we don't have to spend from it, then it's all too good.
Okay, just last but not least, the pickup truck for the highway department.
You mean the one that the Warren article
approved?
Well, there seemed to be some discussion at the town that not necessarily consensus on what the purpose of the truck was going to be. So that would be the first thing that I would want to know is what I thought when we were putting the budget together was just some truck, I mean even a used truck, just so that you're not having to use the Ford. Not that we would have another plow truck or another plow or this, that, or the other. That was my understanding. I don't know about the rest of the board.
The understanding of the CIP for the national.
Mm-hmm.
So
I was just going to say that if you have a different point of view, and if you don't think, you know, a $20,000 vehicle could be helpful, if we don't feel it could be helpful, then, you know, we can keep the money in the CIP and you know, the committee can look at it again in the summer.
The most up-to-date state bid sheet?
We do, actually. I actually have some price breakdowns right here. When we're putting this all together, I mentioned, because I looked at the state bid back when we were doing this, and I believe I thought I put down like 22 or 23,000 for that one.
It was 22, and I think we sort of made it 20. We figured anything over.
That was a state bid. But what made me think about going to an F-250 is when every truck we had was out of service this year. That's, I guess,
what made me think, all right, you know, we should have a spare truck.
I think we can appreciate that, but that's not what we budgeted for. That's not what we planned for. That's not the work we put into it. So, I'm willing to look at the state bid sheet again and see what we can get for what we're appropriate. But
yep. If it's not
going to work, then you don't see value in buying the truck that we discussed via the CIP process. Then you shouldn't do it. I mean, I was under the impression that that's why we're doing it.
Yeah, I mean, I
totally agree with Mike. I see your point when that happened, but you didn't come to us, so we could have presented to the town at the town meeting. So we were like, that's not what we budgeted for. So, and I get it, but that's, I knew $20,000 would not cover that.
So an F-250 state bid price right now is $25,689. And then if we were to put a plow on it, years down the road or next year, our price is $5,070. If we run with the F-150 they were originally going with, the state bid is $21,361 for that truck. That's with a V6 four-wheel drive pickup truck. And that truck would be mainly used for parts and to work out of on the side of the road.
But not suitable for...
It's not suitable.
So, I mean, I know that the intent, as Michael said, the intent of the CIP, the intent of the board, was a...
To run for parks.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Another minor work around town.
Exactly.
It was to save wear and tear on the 550, so...
Now, that doesn't mean to say... I mean, we can change our minds, right? If there's some value in what you're doing, but we probably will not do it this year. So then we as a board need to decide what's more important, to start to get, you know, to reduce the wear and tear on the Ford by this truck, and then it's going to be its main purpose for being.
Yeah.
Do some light errands around town. He could pick a brush. There are things, other things I'm sure it would be helpful in doing, correct?
The what truck? The F-150?
Yes.
Oh yeah, we could use it as an everyday truck, and then when the police department needs it to either run trash or put barricades out or to pick up a stolen bike or whatever they may need,
right.
You know, they can run and grab the truck and be able to use it as well as us, along with the fire department if they happen to need it for whatever those reason.
I mean, it's a really different discussion if you're thinking of another plow truck.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right,
and that's not
the same on gas.
Right, and that's not right,
so,
exactly.
So an F-250 averages about 14 miles to the gallon around town. An F-150 is about 17, and at F-550, I'm about 6.5 to 7.
And if it has sand on it?
It's loaded or empty, I'm 6.5 to 7.
Okay.
So let me a fuel mileage, you know, I don't do a lot of turnpike driving, so. So 14 to 17, I mean, to me, it's a big difference, but on the other end, it's...
When does when do the bids change, the state bids, the state contracts? Are they at the state fiscal year? So July 1?
Correct.
So what we're juggling right now that you and the board should be aware of is just general cash flow.
Okay.
And so if there were, so on the one hand, we want to start to, if we're going to do this, you know, we'd like to, as soon as possible, enjoy the benefits of the reduced gas mileage. On the other hand, you know, cash flow purposes, maybe
yeah.
We should wait until closer to July. But that's,
if we
know,
order
I could
this
be swayed
truck,
either way.
I think we'll have to order the truck, and it's about six, seven weeks to order the truck.
We wouldn't have to pay for it until we take delivery.
From what I understand, no.
And well, so the state, if you don't mind, the state bid sheet, do you have a copy of it there?
I don't have a copy of it. I can.
Right, so we had it for the CIP, and I don't have it in front of me. I apologize. But. Are we tied to the Ford Motor Company? There are two other major manufacturers that could be cheaper. I mean,
so I don't think GM did this year. I don't have the sheet in front of me. I don't even think GM
is on there. I remember
seeing
Chrysler.
And I think
Dodge,
Chrysler.
More expensive, so.
Chrysler, I think, was more.
I'm trying to remember why we settled on Ford. So.
Yeah.
It could have been that.
Would you be able to make up the difference in that cost from your budget?
Absolutely. So you, so we'll have the base truck, and by the time we letter it, and the chief is going to actually give us some of his used radios when he updates all of his, so we'll have to pay to install the radio in it, and then a light bar. So we're looking at an additional $800 on top of the $21,000 to outfit the truck. So
so could you can we wait a week?
Absolutely.
So I would like to think about this, and the board.
I don't think we're going to be able to do it before 6 or 7 weeks before July 1 anyway.
Yeah, probably. But so think about where that money would come from, because I know we're already over budget with assault by a bit. So that would be helpful. And I know we've asked you this 3,000 times, but there's plenty of room to garage it, right? At the,
absolutely.
Yeah, okay, I thought so. Okay. All right, so we're going to think about this. And the next time it comes up, you know, we'd like to know what the total cost is. So the lettering, the radio, whatever. Some
approximation. Yeah, add $800 on top of that.
And where?
$360.
Preferably on a little on an email or something. So, you know, because it's gone. What's your name?
Exactly.
I'm not good. So that it would be helpful, Jeff. So in the email.
Because it's only one by 9 votes.
I don't mean to be, I mean,
I know.
It passed. That's the it passed. So that's what he has to, you know, work with Caroline, look at your budget. You know, it's going to have to deal with the salt overage, and we need to see what the road bids come in at too, because I don't know if you were hoping to do some patching again this year.
I was hoping to in some areas.
So let's think about that. Let's think about where that comes from. Let's, you know, I think we need some, maybe some more clarity on the whole road resurfacing, so that we know what amount we're dealing with. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, but hang on to that. No, we haven't done this yet. Have we done the uniform thing? No.
No, it's still sitting here.
Yeah. Did you take a look at it?
Yeah.
So again, the important things are, it is $1,650 and some change for a year, for up to 5 years, but we can.
So it says that, right?
Do you have a more important preference? Is the uniforms or truck? Or are they both as important to you?
The uniform is a health issue, if you recall.
So,
yeah. Uniform is a health issue.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure that we have it. And it's budgeted.
Yes.
And it's less than what we budgeted, so you can pick up some money.
$1,500
there you go.
Less than what we budgeted.
Yeah, so you picked up a few bucks there.
So it's
are you thinking that you're trying? Are you thinking that you want to? That you're not ready for this to accept this?
No, because then we can put that into this when we have to. The leftover.
The leftover. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. All right. So, shall we? Back to this. So there's both the purchase order, and then there's also the contract. Would one of you like to move this?
We did.
I don't think we did.
Yeah, we did. Voted, I think.
I saw it. Did we?
I think we did.
Well, we've done it. I think we were still looking at it.
I don't think.
Yeah, I think we were still looking at it.
Mike asked where they would change.
Yes.
Nope.
Nice job.
Move to accept, are we ready now?
Yes, I think
so. Okay, kind of bring her coffee. Move to accept purchase order 94040 uniforms for Highway Department and Transfer Station employees for 1 year for a total of $1,650.48.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right, so I'm going to sign both the purchase order and the quote, the accompanying quote.
If you look, there's a couple of pages that need signatures.
Thank you.
Got highlighted.
Thank you. That's a good thing to do. And I will say here, so the quote will be with it.
Okay, so all we need to do is give a written notice of non-renewal, at least 90 days prior to the expiration. So, okay, I'll initial that. And it will be a 3% increase next year if we continue with it. There's too much to do here at this.
No, I believe that's for Caroline.
Okay, just, do you want me to just sign it?
Probably just wherever your signature's required, but the rest of it I can leave Caroline to fill out. It's all information on.
Yeah, just address and name, yeah, exactly. Town clerk got a phone call from Marshall High School, and there are some students who are wanting to do community service, and she was suggesting that they do, you know, the cross street cleanup that we usually have grades, RGS students do.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
So, Siri,
it's
please.
Off. I'm sorry.
So, this is, it's next Wednesday, is that April 5th is next?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So if the snows are gone, and if they work there on April 5th from 11:30 to 1:30. Would you be available in the last hour of that to, you know, load the lead, whatever they bring down to the end of the?
Yeah, I should be available. Okay. But with the amount of snow that's down there.
There's
no way?
No. Yeah, this is
really warm.
Yeah, so there's a significant amount of snow.
It's gotta be, no joke, at least 5-6 feet tall, the snow pile that at the end of Cross Street. I mean,
mm-hmm.
Honestly, that's
wow.
Yeah. I'll send the town clerk an email to say that it's the considered opinion of the road agent board members who live
there.
Can we
do it in July or August?
Or the kids out of school,
I don't know. I have to do it before they graduate, something like that. So I'll just say that.
Before they graduate.
It just doesn't seem to be a feasible place, and then we'll see what happens, and you can work with. We'll see. I mean, you know, we're kind of like the middlemen here. We're not really managing this, so I'll try to facilitate a conversation between you and Kate, and she will do the same with Marshwood. And
I mean, even where there would be cleaning, it's
yeah,
snowpack.
Yeah,
still pretty.
Yeah,
well,
the
garden.
We've been trying to get to the gardens to do some bed maintenance, and
yeah,
we keep putting it off.
Yeah.
All right, I'll just let her know. I'll email you regard to that. Okay. Transfer station closure planning. I hear from Caroline that you're wanting to have a conversation about assuming that, so our bond board went through, assuming that we get financing for the project for the transfer station.
Yes.
I think what you're suggesting is that you're going to have to want, you need to think about that perhaps the.
Yeah, all the work that's going to be taking place in that facility. I hope it's taking place, from the reclaiming to the rebuilding of the wall to the laying of the slab for the new compact to install. I mean, we're looking at, I would say, at least a week's worth of shutdown for the transfer station, if it would be possible. We'll let the guys go in there and do what they need to do and get out.
I'm hearing silence here and sighs, but
I'm thinking.
Yeah. Or
maybe open just Saturday.
Yes. Right.
Saturday.
I mean, if we could.
Providing it safe for the public.
Yes. If we could stage this, that would be my druthers.
Right.
I mean, I could see us asking the town to forego using the transfer station for, like, you know, those weekdays, the Monday, Wednesday. It would be really difficult to include Saturday, and we'd have to think about some other arrangement with another town. We'd have to do something.
So maybe just Saturday. Open.
Yeah, and we'd stage it somehow so that, you know, we could, you know, cordon off, or, you know, I don't think any of us knows what this is going to look like,
yeah.
but that's what we need to think about. So I'm glad you're bringing this up.
I'm thinking of even, because I'm afraid the retaining wall may not be done in a week, so you can't get over there. So could you have a dumpster over closer to the gate?
We'll have to figure something out.
And then throw it in there.
I'm not sure how the contractor's going to handle it. Putting that wall up should be a one-day project, maybe a two-day project at the most, once you have all the materials there. Other than that, it's just going to be the reclaiming, regrading, any structures that you might put in, drainage, whatever they're planning on doing.
Well, so we're going to wait till there is a proprietary quote that's coming in that we're going to consider, but we haven't received it yet, so we'll wait for that. And I would say that's, at the point at which we're ready to do that, we can start talking about, just making sure that whoever the contractor is, that they will be willing to work with us to minimize the aggravation, the inconvenience to the town.
Absolutely.
Because I don't know that we could justify having it closed for over across a Saturday.
No, it may be closed for the full week, and they may need to do touch-up stuff on the existing days.
So I feel comfortable we can manage that sort of thing.
And maybe if they come in low enough, we might be able to put a new gate up at the transfer station, which would be a wonderful.
That would be our road agent's dream of several years.
That would be.
Let's see.
That way people can't take it off the hinges.
Let's see what comes in as. We certainly would consider that, I think. I don't know why we wouldn't, but we'd have to see what it.
He's so hopeful.
He is hopeful.
I'm
a hopeful man. Right.
I'll avoid everything else.
Nope. Again, I'll keep you posted on the cross street thing, but I haven't looked at it lately.
I was looking into the Volvo. You were gonna see if we could trade it.
I've called. So Case has come by. John D has come by. JCB's come by. I have to get hold of that. And I've not heard anything back from any of them as of yet. But a lot of the, like I mentioned before, a lot of the winter leases don't come back in until the middle of April, end of April. So once all their used equipment starts coming back in, I think is when we'll hear from to see what is equal to us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, and we still haven't gotten the correct snow haul removal from Mick.
Carolyn's not here.
I got a purchase order with no bit, no thingy.
So it's still the purchase order. I'll make a note of that and see if you could please talk to her yourself too.
Yes.
I don't always.
I will.
I
will contact her tomorrow and then we'll try and get that taken care of.
Anything else, Jim?
No.
Okay. Cool. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right,
Jeff.
Shh.
Well,
you both here.
He was here long before I was, so.
Chief and chief.
Okay. What? A couple of items, and then
see on here the fire engine plane.
Well, that's still from last week.
I got some update on that for you.
I have a little bit of an update.
You do?
Well, only in that I'm continuing to work on the loan application to USDA. I told the board members I'd submitted it last week, and I immediately get back, oh, you get this, and this. So I'm looking through all those this and this's. But in the meantime, I've also started an application to the New Shabon Band, which I will tell the board about later on. So that's our fallback for all of this.
And I spoke with Councilman Walensky on Saturday, I think it was.
Oh. Is it on the agenda?
Make sure it gets on. It wasn't on this last Wednesday.
So we don't know about the grant yet. That's the grant. So we're still unsure about the grant. And that will make a difference too. Once that is completed and we get it, then we can reduce the amount.
I didn't think that if it had been awarded by DES, he couldn't imagine why there would be an issue. But he would call to see if it's on the schedule for the upcoming meeting.
Then you just want some more?
Sometimes, twice.
Okay. All right.
Okay, a couple purchase orders we'll take care of. I heard a question about the credit card. We've used it once. We used it through Caroline. Make sure we follow all the procedures. These two here, you know, just on the cusp of that, one of these he actually requested that I get the purchase order for you. And it's number 1134, Fisher Auto Parts. It was for a new battery to sell them with the forest. You know, that last storm that started developing some mechanical issues, and we tied it back into that. So, she's just taking care of the purchase order thing. She's aware of it. So it's 1134-170-290 for the solenoid and the battery.
I'll move purchase order number 1134 to Fisher Auto Parts for a new battery and solenoid for 1172-90.
Second.
Any discussion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Because you're aware, we do use that for plow and maintaining the station. But then during large storms like that, a lot of times what we'll do is if a certain medical aid calls in the community with York ambulance is coming over, we'll go with that. In the middle of a storm like that, we have to follow 18 inches. Nobody's got their driveways clear, nothing's open.
Right.
So we always run that with it in conjunction, a lot of personnel, just to make it that much easier because people are going to do it now. So we started developing some issues. We've since diagnosed and took care of that. One thing that's kind of worked in our favor is we had a new firefighter we put on about 2 months ago who's actually works for the Elliott Highway Department. Mm-hmm. He's also on Elliott Fire, but he's also a mechanic. So
nice.
We've been able to do some of the small troubleshooting things. He ran a load test on the alternator because we thought that might have been an issue. He has all that equipment. He changed the solenoid, he got the proper batteries to go and stuff. So we're kind of an in-house guy to take care of a lot of these little things that were always just a pain to get, you know, down the doors and taken care of. So I guess the same thing would go for you, Chief. I guess you have a guy that says your stuff a little bit, don't you, for some of you?
Yeah, we used to. It does work for someone.
He doesn't. Well, if there's stuff that you maybe need diagnosed, you might want to run it through us. We might be able to help you out with some of that stuff.
Okay, thank you.
Second one I have is for more medical. And this is basically to restock some of the medical supplies that we've used on some calls. It's like anything else, some things have a shelf life, so off they go on an annual basis. So it's number 1133, more medical for 125.96.
Accept purchase order 1133 to Moore Medical to restock medical supplies for $125.96.
Any discussion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Chief, I'm forgetting. Do you take these back or I'm keeping?
What you got there?
Your purchase order.
Usually they'll stay here.
Okay. And the police chief.
They go over to Carolyn.
Yeah. She takes care.
Yeah. Okay, the other thing I have back to the fire truck plan. Last Monday night when I left here, we went back to the station, and the representative from one of the manufacturers, and actually it is the manufacturer that we're going to go with, everything falls through, is Tony. We sat through, and these are the two bid packages that they give you. We went through line by line by line on every nut and bolt that would be put in a brand new fire truck, made our adjustments, and basically he is taking this back. They draw up a schematic. They finish their changes and pricing and whatnot, and then they come back to us. He notified us on Thursday that this was in the process and they were expediting it through their engineering department for the fact that they think they can slide us up. Actually, they told us they would slide us up into that 240 to 270 slot. Basically, they're willing to take a couple of months off the manufacturer of this thing by sliding us up. Once
where
we get this...
Where does that bring us?
October, before the snow flies, if you want to go that route. So what I almost expected something back before today, but I imagine in the next couple of days. And what will happen is we'd have to have it signed. It's going to go through, of course, the board's going to sign. Usually there's a financial person that signs, and I guess that still encompasses your position. So maybe you're a twofer. Of course, I'm going to be signing the slot, and then that's all it's going to take initially to get this thing rolling. There's no money up front. We've talked about.
When is the first money?
And as far as they said, they don't have an actual payment schedule. They only want half up front, asking, we'll give you some more here, and it's on.
Is it really on delivery?
You can do that.
Does it affect the cost?
No. No, so if we wanted to push this out till we take delivery, no, that's an option.
Well, that's a very attractive option, because the, you know, I hope to get the USDA fire engine plan in this week. And I don't remember the timetable for when we find out, but, you know, the loans that we did in January, we still don't have an answer to.
Mm.
The bond bank, is, their application is due next week, so I need to get this, I'm trying to get this in this week. And that's, you know, unless we had lousy credit, I mean, that's pretty much guaranteed.
Yeah.
I mean, they're out there to lend us money, and if we're willing to pay the bond price, they're willing to, or be the broker in making that happen. So, but you know, so the board will have to say, we'll have to feel it, yes, okay, we know that we're going to be getting the financing, so by the time this comes in October, we will have a okay. So that's kind of like the process, you know.
Oh,
would I prefer to know, like, right now? That, yeah.
Yeah,
of course. But,
of course, everybody would like
yeah,
to see that all lined
yeah,
out
exactly.
And follow the plan.
But,
and I know there's a lot of moving parts, obviously.
Yeah.
The thing is, these are, and I've said it before, and I know there's some suggestions, you know, why don't we wait a little, we're behind an eight ball, if we wait, we would never get this within the time frame that we're looking for.
No, understood. I mean, we've got, because we have constraints that tell us
right.
We have to get this sooner in order to,
right.
for the purposes of the grant, blah, blah, blah. So,
and
yes.
It's almost kind of, you know, I don't want to say shooting in the dark, but I know the finances are coming, and we all understand that, but we don't have them all the ducks in a row yet.
Yeah, it's just
so,
that level of uncertainty, but knowing that it's October or thereabouts, I feel much better, because by that, the bond bank is going to release funds in July. So, you know, the application is due like next week.
Yeah.
We commit in June, so we still have till June to figure out if we're using the bond bank. You know, if two out of the three loans come through USDA, we just borrow what didn't, you know what I mean? They're very, we don't have to commit until this one date in June. And if the answer is zero, we're all set, everybody's fine.
And these fire truck manufacturers do, and they don't always require money on the upfront end of it. And it depends on what the municipalities want to do, because there is a percentage of municipalities that start getting a fire truck built for them, and then for whatever reason, things fall apart, and they withdraw that. The truck's already being built in the production line. So what they'll do with a lot of that equipment is they'll either use it as a demo, or they'll use that and try to match it up with another community, because it's not uncommon for things to just fall apart when a municipality orders it. So they understand that, and that's one of the reasons why they don't say, okay, we want all this kind of money up front, because if it does fall apart. So they are willing, and it's common practice again in their industry, is to allow it to slide a little bit towards the end of the production line and then the front line. So they're used to all that stuff. We explain it. The only
yeah,
for that big money,
well,
you want something in our
feel,
in order to do this.
Yeah, thing. I mean, I feel that the bond bank is going to be there for us, so that's the sort of deal.
The thing with fire trucks, even when they're building and something falls apart for them, they're still going to find a market. It's not like they're just going to sit on a used car lot or
right.
a used fire truck lot forever. They are going to get gobbled up by somebody else. When I was working in Gold, we bought $1 million ladder truck that was designed for the fire department in Texas. They lost their funding at the last minute. They threw it back out. There was $1 million ladder truck. They got a break in a quarter. They were all over it. They loved it. And it worked well for them within what they needed, so it was okay. And it's not uncommon, like I said. So going back to that, he could come back to me in a couple of days and say he's ready to go.
Bring the purchase order next week.
Okay.
Bring the purchase order when you're ready. Then we'll take the gulp and we'll look at
yeah.
it. Yeah,
because that's where we're at right now.
Or two.
Gulp is... We went through all this, like I said, it's gone back to their engineering department. They're drawing up all the schematics. They'll come back because what they had given us before was basically under the under 216 and now 2017. There'll be a slight bump, slight changes to some of the things we adjusted. He says it's still going to come under the number that we had down and approved. So once he gives us that, I'll come with the purchase order. But also with the purchase order will be the proper paperwork to sign so that they can...
And the board is, you know, so we know we have three quotes. This is the quote that Chief has accepted, and we're all right with the okay
yes.
process. Okay, good. So, okay, well.
I just wanted to let you know that
yeah,
we're right
I
on
understand.
The verge of taking
okay.
that big step. There,
yeah,
so.
This is the piece that we knew we were going to be wanting to address sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, of course. floor plan, just the way that this market goes.
But I'm happy that they don't need money upfront, that makes me feel better.
I was kind of surprised too when we started talking about that. He understands the whole process on where we are with this grant and bond banks and everything else, so he's more than skilled with that. I said, well, that's fine. You get the okay from your board, we sign the paperwork, and off it goes. Don't worry about funding right away, so it gives us a little bit of time to put all our pieces together.
How do you spell the name of that company?
Toyne, T-O-Y-N-E. That's our chosen manufacturer. Okay, all the six that we started with, that's the company right there. And like I said before, you know, they were kind of an upstart in the area 3-4 years ago, now they've got 6 pieces of apparatus in the area, so it's kind of a good thing, because this guy that's the salesman and helping the store is also the mechanic. So it's going to be locally serviced tomorrow. We're going to have to take it. If there's some manufacturer, if we needed service, either had to go to Springfield, Mass, or Connecticut. It's like, no. But we're not having a Caterpillar engine, we could have gone to Scarborough, Maine, but it's going to be Cummings. So he has a shop, I figure, for some place in southern Maine that takes care of all this stuff. So that's another plus. And another reason why we decided to go with his group. So.
Okay.
All right, anything else for me?
No, other than I'm pursuing, and I'll talk to the board about, you know, digital letterhead.
Yes, you got my reply?
I did, yes.
And we're all for it. We're not going to be the ones that come to the anchor. We'll help move that forward.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jim.
Good evening.
Hi.
Happy Monday.
Indeed.
I will not be here next Monday.
Boston.
Is it open? It's opening day.
Just a 4-1 now.
Yeah, who's playing?
They're playing the Pirates.
I heard that. Yeah, they're in inter whatever. Okay. It is weird, opening day. It's odd, but whatever. Nothing's the same, everything changes.
No, that's true. I have one purchase order for Digital Ink in Summersworth. We need to reorder our primary accident information form that we use at the motor vehicle accidents. Actually, a 3-part form. One goes to us, and then we have copies to go to the drivers. So it'll be line item number 506, our forms account, purchase order number 1151 for no more than $250.
Purchase order number 1151 for our primary accident info form for $250.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Actually, I have a question. It's not related to the purchase order, but does Digital Ink have your a digital version of the shield that's on your letterhead?
I'm sure they do.
Can you ask them? Do you want me to ask them?
Oh, yes.
Ask them, because if they can send that to us, then it's kind of like, I haven't mentioned it to the board, but Kristen would be able to incorporate it in a digital letterhead for the police department.
Our plan is to eventually do away with all printing except for the couple of forms that we need for multiple carbon copies. Other than that, like stationery, things like that, we should be able to do in-house eventually.
So let me bring it up with the board so I'm not like dancing around something. So so for the annual report that we do, it's a nice thing to put online with access to the individual pieces. So if somebody's looking at the index and they just want to go to the police report, they just pick it. They want to, so but meanwhile, this thing is one glom scan. And so you have to go through this whole PDF or whatever.
Right.
So in thinking about how to make this better, I did talk to Michelle Robbins who printed this. But the police and the fire department want their annual report to come on their logo.
Right.
And so I said, aha. Well, just as Kristen designed the letterhead for us, she would be willing to design letterhead for the police department incorporating that shield if we can get it electronically. And
very
for
nice
the RFD, well, at for $50.
Still very
yes.
Nice.
So that way you wouldn't have to order any pre-printed paper, and you wouldn't have to get up and put in the letterhead paper and then, you know, put it, you know.
That's right, correct.
And if it's something that needed a signature, then you just print it out, sign it, and do whatever. For our annual reports, I'm hoping, I know the board doesn't sign it, ours, so, you know, it would be from the police, and hopefully that would be enough, and that way we would just have a digital version, and we can
make it. Makes sense.
Okay, so that's what, so I'll talk to the board about the price later on, and we'll get a sort of consensus, but if you could see if they can get that nice shield, because sure. Kristen took one look at that and said, I could never do that.
I'm sure we can work something out.
Okay, great.
We were notified by WEX, W-E-X, that they now have the state contract for the fuel card program. This is separate from the state fuel pumps. Okay. We already have an account with WEX for the Exxon Mobil.
Okay. So WEX is the company that we use right now?
Right. They're the administrator of the non-government programs.
That we use.
But they do, WEX also does have a program now, and they have a state contract, whereas you're no longer required just to go to either Exxon or Mobil. You can go to Irvine, Gulf, Marathon, I mean, there's like 75 different companies that you can use. And the reason I'm bringing this up, because we look at the advertised price of Mr. Mike's compared to the Irvine Summersworth, there's usually a 12 to 15 cent difference. So I don't know at this point, but I'm kind of hoping that if we started to use Irving and Summersworth, there may be a little bit the drop of difference between using the Irvine gas as opposed to using the Mobil or Exxon gas. So I'm going to recommend to the board that we sign up for the second WEX account, try it for a month, and see if there's actually a cost benefit for us. And if there is, then all we have to do is just use this card as opposed to using this card for Exxon and Mobil.
So there's no risk to this. I mean, there's just a second opportunity.
There's still no cost to join the program. There's no administrative fees. So it should be a win-win situation, one way or the other.
Yeah.
So I should do it.
Yeah. Do you have any concerns?
Or it seems to be the application, Caroline.
Okay. I think it is Irving. Is it Irving?
Irving.
Irving. Yes, it's Irving, yeah. Circle K.
Irvine is California.
Summersworth uses it.
Yeah, Summersworth, the door swapped over to Irving. We use Irving. Mr. Norman Giroux and his one-man crew, they're in the station today, Jack Cameron. So we now have two great big deep holes within the station. And tomorrow you're going to see a cement truck parked over on 4th Street filling the holes.
Okay.
So that should be done. They said it'll take about 3 weeks for it to properly cure, and then they'll come back and they'll put the tile down for the
so it'll just be the raw, sort of like the cement for
it. And the last item that I have for you folks, based upon our conversation last week with the lieutenant and the board, I'm going to recommend to the board that we adjust the lieutenant's salary to $61,000, and the difference from the current salary to the 61 will come out of our part-time account. So the bottom line won't change whatsoever. We'll just take a couple thousand dollars from the part-timer's account and just adjust it to his line item.
Okay, just so the public knows, this is just a result of a conversation we had in non-public last week with Chief, with Lieutenant Raskovich, and so we're happy to get that recommendation. Does the board have any board ready to act on this? Yeah, okay. I'll entertain a motion to increase the lieutenant's salary to $61,000. So moved.
Seconded.
Any discussion further? All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay, thank you.
Anything for me?
Just the letterhead. That was it. Was there anything else?
So tomorrow night's my understanding is the Water and Sewer District meeting. Do we have an officer that's attending that? So we have one at the town meeting. We just have one at the school district meeting. Do we have anyone going?
I haven't planned on having one there unless we anticipate that there might be something that was boisterous.
Well, there's always someone that was boisterous.
What time is that?
7, it's supposed to start 7 o'clock.
7, somewhere in the grade school, I'm not sure exactly where.
They don't, didn't say it, it just said 7 o'clock at the grade school, so.
Okay, 7 o'clock, I'll have someone there.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Why are we, the police and water district meeting?
It's the annual meeting, just like our town meeting and like the school district annual meeting.
Okay, so the supervisor, I guess I didn't realize the supervisor of the checklist, you know that, not me?
I'm not sure about that.
Okay.
Commissioner is supposed to organize that, I don't know, maybe the moderator.
Yeah.
I don't know, I don't remember who the moderator is.
I think if you read the minutes, they left one right there.
I do, yeah, but I don't know who it is this current year.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Town administration, board appointments. So when I was working on this, where do you have papers? I was working on this last week, you know, we did a bunch of appointments. So, I'm gonna look on this one. So, I got confused, so I just wanna make sure that, can I follow this for just a minute?
Absolutely.
So I just wanna make sure that they were good, and there are a couple of things I want us, if we don't make changes this year, that we think about for next year. So, select board, we're elected, no change there, I've got the terms down. I think I have everything fine for the budget committee. When the water district and the school district appoint their ex officio, we'll put that in. The conservation commission, we didn't do that last week, I did check with Al. He was hoping that, and I didn't hear back, that either Lorraine would be appointed, he would recommend that Lorraine be appointed to a full position, she's currently an alternate, and Herb Uetta would be appointed as an alternate or vice versa. So, but he didn't get back to me in time for this meeting. Planning board, so here is the problem that I don't know if it's a problem, here was the anomaly that I ran into with the planning board. So we've got, so Mike, there are only like four appointed members and one ex officio, is that, did I have that right? So you're the ex officio. Are there five plus you?
And no, four, and then ex officio and two alternates.
So the five-member board that includes the select board's ex officio. All right, so what I saw is that we've got, so it's a four, in other words, only really four appointments, because the ex officio is a one-year thing,
right.
So only four appointments, and normally you don't want to have them all in the same year, so
right.
At the moment there are 2020 and 2019s, and nothing for 2018 as far as the full member.
Correct.
So we can either keep this, you know, we can either not change it, or we can, you know, I was just wondering, we appoint like Kevin for a one-year term, or Miles for a one-year term, not Miles, one of the 2020 appointees for a one-year term, or just wait till next year. I haven't notified anybody yet.
So two would be up in 2020, and two would be up in 2019. Why would you
not? As three-year terms. So we have nobody coming up next year.
Right.
So they're not well staggered, that's all. If we don't think there's a problem with that, then we'll just let it be. I'm okay with that. It's sort of nice to get them staggered. I think the RSAs suggest staggered terms, but
there's only four of them, so
it's not going to be even, but it would allow us to do some. So I have a candidate for the alternate, and I've asked her to submit something to the board, so we'll just hang on to that till we get something. But Michelle is a planner. She's been a planner with the Stratford Regional Planning Commission. She works as a planner for the city of Rochester, and she's just graduating with a Master's of Public Administration from the University of New Hampshire. So I think she'd be an excellent alternate, but I've asked her to submit something to the board. So again, if you look at the zoning board is good, it's staggered with 18, 19, 20.
Right.
The Highway Safety Committee, those are annual recommended, so we were fine. Rec, I think I've got them all okay.
Yep.
And they were fine. Historical was fine. Stormwater was fine. It was, my question, I guess, was just the staggered, or lack of staggeredness with the planning board.
Stormwater, you did not do officially once.
Oh, is this one of the ones I was going to do?
Okay. Yeah.
All right. I would like to appoint the same membership that we currently have. So if one of you would like to make the motion.
Sure. I move that we nominate Paul Cazal, Sean Glidden, Michael Point, and Nate Mears to serve on the Stormwater Management Committee.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And Salma, I'll send this to you now that it's in a good, a nicer form. And I'll also send this to the town clerk, and I'll send this to the website.
I'd love that for you.
Would you like a copy of this as well?
No, I'll get it on the website. I think it's wonderful.
So it's a nice, clear.
I love the organization.
Yeah, thank you. And it also points out those cases where we have recording secretaries,
mm-hmm,
where there are consultants, like our planning consultant.
Thank you.
And our stormwater consultant, so things are, everything's there. All right, super duper, thank you.
Okay.
And the Conservation Commission, I think.
Put this in the folder, please.
No, it's yours. I'll tell you, better at home, you can just have it for yourself.
Okay.
So the Conservation Commission is the only one that we're waiting on.
Sure.
Planning Board Consultant, I asked John Chris, I think we did appoint him last week, but mm-hmm. he's going to, I wanted to send us a contract, and
he did.
He know, oh, did he?
I thought I
did. It come today?
Might have been so.
Oh, all right. I did not see that.
I thought I did.
Caroline was
249 today. Isn't that it?
He probably is. I guess I wasn't on the system.
It's a contract between the town and John Craig's for your review.
Oh, no. See, so we sent this to John so he could use it as a template to get back to us.
I see.
So he hasn't filled it out yet. I thought he had this, and then he says, you know what, I can't find mine. So we don't have any.
And we had something from 4 years ago to send.
Yeah, we did.
How awesome
was that? It was, and I could have just used it myself and made a template. I thought he had it, and so now we've got this back and forth. But whatever, we'll figure it out. And to get back to up on the agenda, I don't want to lose sight of it. But if you go back to the building inspector, we got an email from Tom Clark today about the technical review committee. And I should have mentioned it. I should have asked the chiefs if they were willing to serve on such a board. But anyway, would you like to have Tom come and talk to us about the technical review committee and the purpose? And
yeah, and invite the chiefs to be there.
Okay?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I will do that. He did say, I think, in his email that, you know, there's sort of a group that he can pull from, but that they wouldn't, depending on what the application is, he wouldn't necessarily need
right.
everybody for every
exception. Right.
Budget. Caroline, unless there's something in our thing, I don't think she was quite ready to give us the across the board for everybody for us to sign off on,
right.
But she's working on it.
It's not my board.
Okay. All right, so for the New Hampshire Municipal Board, New Hampshire Municipal Bond Bank, so the application is due soon, and I am asking the board whether you are comfortable with me signing it when it's ready to be submitted. I could show you those pieces right now so you know what an application looks like. Let me bring it up. So this is the signature page. This is the first thing that's there. And then there's a page that says, you know, we want to borrow again, you know, $1,000, $25,000, which again is not a commitment, we'll be able to change this.
I think you mean 1 million.
What?
1 million.
1,025,000.
You said 1,000.
I remember.
Please borrow more than that.
They want to know the name of our bank, because they'll wire the proceeds there. They wanted to know our number of full-time and part-time employees, so we have 7 full-time and 17 part-time. None of them are unionized. They, 2 pages are being filled out by the Rollinsford School District, because they have to do with the number of students and that sort of thing. Then there's the schedule of payback, so which again we can work on, but they've got it down to a, I think a 15-year term. They want to know what our level of indebtedness is, and there is none. The water district does have indebtedness, but somehow it's not net indebtedness. I don't fully understand, but when they filled it out for the USDA,
yep,
you know, they had Tom Dumay filling it out, so that's it. We have no current outstanding debt, so it would just be what they were proposing. We have no short-term debt. We are hoping not to arrange for any short-term debt, but that's the question about, I said maybe, we need a bond application note, bond anticipation note. I said maybe, depending on when things have to get paid and when they may release the funds. You know, the next one, I think, maybe the transfer station. Maybe the culverts, although the culvert timeline, I think, is sort of later because they still have to do some of the specking. This is, again, another question about overlapping debt, and we said that we don't have any debt. They wanted to know the our town valuation, so they were able to fill this in ourselves from the DRA, so they know our property valuation, and it looked correct. They want to know the date of our last reval, 2012, and date of the next one, 2017. The amount of our amount of uncollected taxes. Mm-hmm. And so we have 0 for 2012, 0 for 2013, a little over 6 for 2014, 19 for 2015, and 73 for 2016. It's interesting what they want to know. They wanted to know that our top 10 taxpayers.
Yep.
So we got that. Any of these who were more than 90 days delinquent in any of the last 3 years, there was one. I want to know our top 5 employers and the number of employees. So Carolina's in the process of finding that out. So it's Janko and Hannaford and C&J and
I don't know, great.
Wentworth, yeah. Sure. So in the process of finding that out. And then we need some stuff, building permits and the revenue that we brought in. And we've got it for the last couple of years, but not for all of it, so Carolina's checking with the DRE. So that's the application. This is hours as opposed to weeks with the USDA. This is, I mean, the scale is so different. This is so much easier than what the hoops we're going through with the USDA. So are you comfortable with my submitting this on our behalf when it's ready, and I'll file it up on the Google Drive when it's done. I won't sign this yet until then. I'm really ready to sign it. But this is the authorization. If you want to take a look at it.
I appreciate you doing all that work.
Well, you're welcome. I would love some certainty. You know, I would love to have something come through so that we don't have
problems. Oh, thank you. Thank you again for doing it.
All right. All right. So there's that. Right to know. I believe I was wrong last week. The right to know request that we had, when I went back to look at it again, it's a question of where the commas are.
Right.
It is a question of where the commas are, and one might have the original interpretation I had, but just to be safe, I think anything that we've generated having to do with the postponement, we should. So I've done mine, I think Charlie's done his, Kane's done hers. So we will need it by, she's either going to come on Friday, why don't you just email them to her?
It's fine, she comes up.
Pardon?
Ms. Olson comes along. I'll just hear by one. You can also charge her for the conference. You can, by statute.
Yes, I understand. Isn't it just email them to her? I mean, that way she's not taking Carolyn's time.
Sure.
So, will either one of you have any difficulty having this done?
No, I'm just going through it again, making sure that I didn't miss any.
I guess my question is, I responded to anything Charlie sent out on that, on the...
I put down anything that originated with me. So even if it was a response, if I just read something, I didn't include.
But if I responded to anything you want?
Yeah, because you can make a PDF of it.
Should you save anything that I responded to? I put in the entire thread minus anything that may be a response from legal counsel or a question directly to legal counsel.
Yeah, I had very little, but I had a few things. I had more than I thought, but actually, when I went through.
I'm like, can you show up on...
Exactly.
Monday.
Right.
Yeah.
That's why I did it. She can sort through them herself.
Yes, I mean, I'm not concerned about overburdening. I mean, you know, if she's asked, we'll just, you know, so whatever's easier for you to do, and you can choose to print it as a PDF and then just... Did I send you? I sent you to Google Drive to store it, because I saw Kate's store.
I had a horrible time opening Charlie's.
I don't know why. Did you finally get it?
Finally, I got it. I opened it from a different program. So.
You could also download.
I did. It would not open on my own computer or my work.
Was it because it was too big?
I don't know. I even downloaded the newest version of Reader to my work computer. No, I didn't need it, but.
Yeah.
I got it open. I just wanted to make sure that I was using a similar template. I wasn't. I'm not worried about it.
Yeah.
She insisted while I'm just kind of providing the information she asked for. So.
Pardon?
13.
So are you all set? You can sort of get that done by...
31st.
Okay. Thank you. And let me know if you have any trouble or need any help. If I can, I would be happy to. We've talked about digital letterhead. What I didn't say was that I asked Kristen if she would be willing to do this, make it look, you know, sort of like follow the town one, but also individualize it with their own logos. And she said for both she would be happy to do it for $50. And it could come out of the...
professional services.
The IT services, yeah. So I didn't do a purchase order. Do you want me to do a purchase order?
Next week,
okay, good. Some of these things I know exactly what it's about on Monday morning, and then I come here and I go, oh. So letter regarding trees at Chinburg.
So my agenda looks a lot different from what you're reading, I think. So
you don't have the right to?
Right to know, then RFP, the
oh,
RFP,
I'm sorry. You know why? It's because right to know is in two places. Sorry.
Okay.
It's in two places. Let's go back to D,
okay.
Right to know. Digital letterhead.
Yeah,
F is bid reviews. We have nothing to review just yet. We're going to wait till we get a second one in.
Okay.
Transfer station stickers. Sorry, I see what the problem is. The right to know is in two places. So we got, I assume we got it all. This person who's here, which one is yours?
The green one.
Thank you. Sorry. Is here part-time, so he doesn't have a New Hampshire registration, he has a Florida registration.
Oh, yeah, so
but both Andrea and Kay have said yes, he does live here. He just doesn't have a registration.
Resides here seasonally.
Yes, seasonal. So are we okay with him?
Yeah.
Okay. Are we okay with him getting a transportation sticker?
No one else is occupying it. From what Andrea said, it was a resident that does not air an order.
Right, he's not bringing his Florida garbage either.
I wouldn't imagine.
Yes.
But.
Right.
Okay.
It's not a business and it's not.
Correct. It's his home. The only issue is he has a Florida registration. Okay, so that's G. H we can ignore because it's the same right to know.
Right.
Sorry about that. Now we're at I, the letter regarding the trees and chimney. So this is the development on Wentworth Street, Chipper Development, and there was an agreement, you probably know this, about trees, right? They were supposed to plant trees.
That was approved after I got on the board, but I'm acquainted with the trees.
Okay, so they, apparently they have planted the trees as the buffer for the Wentworth House, and they're wanting a sign-off, either from the planning board or us or somebody, that they've done their duty. So how do we want to ensure that this is satisfactory to the people for whom it's supposed to be satisfactory? Should we ask Art? Should we ask Tom to look at it? Is it sufficient for one of us to look at it? What is the suggestion?
We should go back and look at their, it should be spelled out in their, I think what it's called, when the plat was approved by the planning board, there's a list of requirements that they have to meet. It should be spelled out on there who's supposed to review it. And like, so like for the road, it's the planning board's consulting engineer, and that's civil. I don't know.
Do you want to see?
I'll see if I can find it. Like I said, before I get on the board, so. I mean, it might have to suffice just sending Tom over to do it, but if it's spelled out specifically, who's supposed to do it?
Okay, that's good. So you can take a look at it and get back to us.
I'll find one.
Okay, super. Thank you, Mike.
I don't know if you've been in the planning board room lately, but it's, it needs to be organized.
I don't believe that's a new state of affairs.
I'm just stating the obvious, so I don't know if I'm going to be able to readily find it right away.
That's all I'm saying. Yeah, okay, so I mean, I think it's fine.
I may have brought up this.
I know Timberg is not on my desk.
Yeah.
That was before me.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have alternatives, so we do a cursory look.
Let's look first, just to make sure we're not.
We don't want you to spend days, but you know.
You know, exactly.
Okay, the next one, item J. So, New Hope Housing has probably several buildings. I think they have a couple of the apartment buildings on the Karras Drive.
Yeah, one over here, right?
And they've asked to be a nonprofit.
Mm-hmm.
And Avatar's response was yes. And so I just want to make sure the board is aware, because it's a loss of like $20,000 of tax revenue if they, and the other thing I will note, because Al Dion specifically came here to talk to me one day about this group.
His issue is the same as my issue.
Go ahead, well, why don't you tell
me? My issue is that they charge at market rate rents. They don't charge subsidized rents. So they're actually, they may be a nonprofit, or they think they're a nonprofit, but they're charging rents, but they're actually a profitable enterprise. So if they're willing to have subsidized rents for low-income folks, then yeah, I might consider it. But unless they're willing to do that, I say thanks, Avatar, for your advice, but I'm saying no.
How are they, what is their nonprofit?
It's called New Hope Ministry or something.
Is their mission statement? And what is the, I haven't seen anything. They don't come across my building at all, is my question. Like, I would have heard of them in my building.
So, you know, I don't want to say a lot of things that, I don't want to say anything defamatory, because I don't know this group, okay? I know that Al Dion is a former select person. A board that he was on kind of went through something similar and rejected it.
We got this last year as well.
Maybe, but they never pursued it. It was a little bit different. Now they've actually applied for an abatement and received a recommendation from Avatar.
Right.
So is it sufficient for the board, if this is what we want to do, to just say, no, we don't accept it? Should we get any legal?
I'd like to talk to legal counsel, to be honest with you.
Yes.
Legal?
Yes.
Because it's $20,000. Okay, so if the board is okay.
We have to, but I would prefer to.
I will tell.
Speak to legal counsel before we do it.
We are reluctant to just accept this.
Yes. One of our consultants always said yes, but that doesn't mean.
Well, you know, sometimes.
For different reasons, perhaps.
Yeah. And you've never come across them, is that what
I have never heard of them at my work, no. Not, they would usually be on a list of people to contact for help, like any 401c3, like that would be on that list of social workers that would have. They're not in the book yet. I will double check the book, because, you know, it gets
Google
updated.
Ministry, something like that, okay.
New Hope Housing.
Comcast franchise renewal. So when we spoke with legal counsel in February, I just was following up and sent to him the letter we recently got from Comcast, as well as the original cable Continental Cablevision agreement.
Right.
And so Steve wrote back to us today. Did you read it? Okay. So let's set the stage for people who aren't seeing the person. So as we think about renewing the contract, the question is, do we want to renew a contract with Comcast?
Right.
Or do we want to open this up? So, I mean, the suggestion was to at least have a public hearing or two.
I think it's a good idea. At least one. I don't know about that, too.
Yeah.
The town of Durham is considering not renewing the...
Who are they going with?
I don't remember. It was in Foster's.
I mean, that's my question. Who else is there, Mike?
What's the one in?
Is it Metrocast?
Metrocast in Rochester, I think.
So they deliver the same kinds of services? So entertainment as well as cable?
I have no idea. I don't know.
Okay. All right. Well, let's...
But we should at least hear from the resident.
Do you think this is, as we think about this, do you think this is a public hearing for this room?
Yeah, I don't think so.
$1 million bond over 12 people, so.
I feel I have to ask. You know,
it's a good question to ask. Sorry, I don't mean to be blunt, but I'm just tired.
So, it sounds like we have a little bit of time. So let's look at our calendars. Let's try to suggest something, though. We've got the public hearing, public information, it's not a public hearing, with Avatar on the 12th of April. We could do something for like May 3rd, a Wednesday. No. Was that a no-go?
Hold on.
I can hold on.
No,
Or we can do it at 6 o'clock. We can do it at 6 o'clock, I think, on a Monday.
Yeah, let's do that.
Do you want to do that?
I don't think it's going to...
Okay. So...
If it brings up a lot of people, then we'll meet once.
Okay.
Yeah.
So... want to try for April 17th? I'm going to draft something and send it off to you, because I don't know, I'm not sure exactly what to say.
We want to do it at 6 o'clock?
Yes. What date did I say?
17.
April when? April 17th? 6 o'clock.
This year.
Okay. Okay. Very good. So administratively, we'll handle it via email just to make sure the draft says something that we need.
Sure. Should be a barn burner.
Maybe we make it 6:15.
Well, I mean,
there could, you know,
I would venture to guess if people actually showed up. I mean, there's enough to complain about with the Comcast service and the prices they charge, but that doesn't mean the next government gets better. So. Yeah.
All right. So the REC committee, is there anything with regard to the REC committee? I think we have an appointment letter in there. You may have come across
it. I have not seen an appointment letter. Didn't you sign that? No, an appointment. We hired her,
but there's now an appointment letter, I think.
I have not seen it.
Isn't that funny? I saw it this morning.
Well, I've been looking
right
through the folder.
Okay.
Not come across it yet.
We'll wait for it to show up. And I know Caroline is trying to get a financial management meeting together.
Yes. One of the things that came up last night is the pool. We're not sure if they would take like conscious order or anything because they do a head count as the kids go in. And last year they had the checkbook. So just broke them.
Yeah.
Check.
So we'll need to figure out an approach.
An approach because you never know how many kids are going to be on that bus that day.
So,
and because our accountant didn't like the way it was done last year. We just have to figure out a new approach to it this year. We also have to find out if the Dover pool, like even if we gave them a town credit card, do they take credit cards at the pool?
It's a municipal pool, right? So
yeah.
I wonder if we could work out a appeal arrangement with them or something.
Yeah. So
monthly or something.
It's just something like
yeah.
that. So and then they're gonna need appeal for the bus and certain things like that. So
okay.
And they just and they're doing an internal tracking of their money. Lester's going to be tracking the income and outcome. So
mm-hmm.
They'll have books as well. So we'll get books at the end of the season. So very excited about that. So they're definitely moving in the right direction, and they're a lot of fun to work with.
Excellent. It's just it's fun to be watching this transpire. So it's great. Credit card. Nobody's really approached us with anything different, so that's just remains on the agenda. The old car machine, did we get any bids?
We did not get the bid. So I don't know if I wrote it, I sent it out. I don't know if Caroline, because the person that said they were interested only gave a phone number. They didn't give an email, so I couldn't email them the form.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, if we hear from that person again, I suppose we just open it up for another 1 week or
yeah, I'll just open up for another
yeah.
2 weeks.
So but meanwhile we have no bids to open. I think Caroline was trying to do that, but I hadn't no bids though. So non-lapsing account for historical committee. Do you want us to just put that off the agenda or maybe you could come back to us when you're ready to talk about that?
Okay. I don't want to lose
yeah,
sight.
Rick's gonna want one too, by the way.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's a good idea. You know, we can ask Caroline to check around with other towns about how they manage the
yeah.
money.
The Municipal Association sent some advice, basically
yeah.
creating a, one of the, under the auspices of the trustee of the trust fund, creating a line there so money can be deposited from that. And maybe just need to the library, the historical committee folks who can come to the select board. And we could authorize the
who has agency over those funds? If they're set up. They're set up
yeah.
by the trustees of the trust funds. Usually that's done at the town meeting.
So we'd have to go that route. Well, yeah, you're right. So that was one avenue and
yeah.
another one. I don't remember what it was, but it was.
Okay. Well, when there's more clarity, and we may, you know, we may come up with some of the ideas with the rec committee that
we
want to
discuss it at our
store.
Next meeting anyway to see.
All right. Then I think the rest of the stuff, nothing on policies and procedures. Town administration standing items, what's up for the board this coming week?
Joint loss was moved for 2 weeks from now because everybody was swamped with everything going on.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt that I asked if they would like to move it. They all agreed. Between
telltale sign.
Lack of Jeff's sleep and currently catching up with everything. They were more than happy to move it 2 weeks. So joint loss will be meeting in 2 weeks.
Okay.
Yesterday, I attended a 100th birthday party. Gave out the Boston Post can on behalf of the
mm-hmm.
state. Everybody was there, and the town clerk was there. It was very nice.
Yep.
Yeah, the proclamation from the government
excellent.
Was very nice.
That's wonderful.
Yeah,
that's
no, it was wonderful. It was very, very nice.
I'm sorry I couldn't be there.
Oh, and I talked to Richard Fogarty about creating a box for cane that can be in our hallway. And he thinks he knows just the right person to build it. So.
That's fine. You want to give a thought?
No, well.
Isn't that what we wanted to do last time?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think we probably should. It would be nice to display the original so it doesn't get lost or broken or anything. But what I want to discuss with the historical committee, seeing if they may be willing to help with the okay at the select board, obviously, raise money to buy one of the replica canes so we can actually still give them out. There's a company in Ohio or Iowa, somewhere in the Midwest, that actually makes these things.
But the one in the glass case
would
be the original, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean
there's historical value, why we don't want to lose it, obviously, but it's also, I mean, telling the family that we don't want the recipient to actually be using it, it's 150 few years old, 17, right? So 112 years old. No, that's not right. 109. I can't add anymore. But anyway, it was over 100 years old. It's made out of African ebony. So and it could be
valuable.
Well, I don't know. Yes, the can itself is valuable. The head on it is 14 karat gold. So
that's true.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But that's not that. I mean, structurally, if it's a 100-year-old piece of ebony, it may not be able to support
100%.
The weight of the person who's using it. So I don't want anyone to get hurt. So there's that on top of it. On top of the historical value, but, and the monetary value, I guess. But the secondary really is one thing hurt at that age. But anyway, she was very, very excited to receive it, I think. So it was a very sweet, nice party. And I've reached out to the American Legion Post to see if they might consider hosting us for elections, start that conversation with them. As we asked last week, they are going to bring it up to their membership at their next meeting. I think they said it was the 11th of April. So
okay.
We'll start the conversation at least.
So are we good with that? Is Richard, did Richard volunteer to do it? Is that the...
No, we just happened to be talking about it after we had displayed it, after Mike handed it out. And I was talking on the sidelines with him, and I said, yeah, when the last time we handed this out, we had talked briefly as a board that we should display it because it's such a wonderful piece of history.
Mm-hmm.
And
would it be nice if we knew the recipients, too? I don't know.
All of them? That's 1909?
It's a nice piece of historical research.
Yes.
Someone wants to look that up.
I'm sure our expert record keepers are kept track. Sorry.
You might want to call Peter. He might know the best.
Well, it's just somebody who looks... I mean, you don't have to have them all at once. You can fill them in, too.
Yeah.
Anyway,
I was like, yeah, you know, a little box and blah, blah, blah. And so he's like, you know, I'm a good board worker that might have the best job for that. So I don't know if that's him or not. I don't know if Richard well enough to know if he does work with him.
And is it a donation, or are they looking for us to...
Oh, we were just briefly discussing this with
the
people.
All right. All right. So maybe the historical committee would want to talk about it, too, someone can come to...
You can't imagine they'd be opposed to it.
Okay. So we'll let that be as a... Is that something to continue to think about?
And we're working on an agenda, an organizational meeting for the planning board for our next.
Yeah, so, you know, John was hoping to get Radigan to...
It's going to be this week, probably the next week.
Okay.
All right. Probably the date was... it would be the 4th, so the notice will be going up soon. It'll just be an organizational meeting. The applicant who wants to do a conditional use permit on the Caras for accessory dwelling unit is not ready to proceed.
Okay.
So
there isn't anything?
Not that I'm aware of, but I can touch base with Sarah just to make sure.
So I have a...
I've just been helping facilitate just so they can organize.
I understand that the planning board is supposed to hold a monthly meeting regardless.
Yeah, that is, I believe, what the statute says.
Mm-hmm. So I know that wasn't always the case. I would encourage the planning board to try to...
Whoever the new chair is.
Yes. Even if it's just
that conversation.
Yes. Thank you, Mike. Okay. If there's nothing else under member activities and updates, we can go right to building permits.
We have a couple.
Have a certificate of occupancy first for 416 4th Street.
Oh, what's that?
I must have asked that house.
Oh,
that
one they've been working on.
Yeah, nice. Tom Rover inspected it, so there you go. That's great. First is 2017-0235 Doherty Lane. It is to install a new shower stall and a half bath. The fee, Mr. Clark has already reviewed it, the fee is $85.
Okay. These are the quotes from the committee, and they ended up here. And I'm just, I don't know if you passed them all to Caroline, but they would get lost at this stage with me.
Do you want to keep them?
She could file them, I guess. I mean, we accepted something when we accepted.
Next one we have is permit 2017-024, 5 Doherty Lane. Add and install the plumbing to go replace existing fixtures to go along with the shower stall has been put in, and it's a fee of $90. Also reviewed by Mr. Clark. And that is all that's in here. Let's see. That's really interesting.
Are going to be coming soon.
I don't know. There's a letter that I'm supposed to, the board is supposed to sign. It. I don't know where it is.
Let me just make sure I didn't get it.
So we've got actually the town clerk got a mail from someone who, it's just one of these unfortunate kinds of things. She's a volunteer with the police department and went to a conference, and the way we chose to pay the conference on her behalf caused us to issue her a W-2, and she's unhappy about that. And so Caroline spoke to our CPA, you know, our auditor, and said that because of how this was the appropriate approach, given all of the circumstances, we should just, you know, not overturn that. So this is the letter to Ms. Whitehouse. The town clerk forwarded to me a letter regarding the W-2 that you received. I'm the person who manages the payroll on behalf of the town. I'm sorry you were frustrated about how this was handled. We value the service of the volunteers very much, and I certainly wouldn't want to jeopardize your willingness to help us out in future over something that could be avoided. I spoke with our CPA to confirm that we followed our standard operating procedure for this circumstance. It's not often that we have people who are not regularly on the payroll getting paid. He concurred that the payment should have gone through the payroll system. If this were as simple as sending you a new form and I was allowed to do that, then I certainly would. But where the payroll deductions were already made and paid on your behalf, they have to be reported. Any such corrections are extremely time consuming and expensive. Therefore, you will have to submit the W-2 you received with your tax return. Should such an opportunity arise in the future that volunteers are working in a paid capacity, I will review with the CPA whether or not it is appropriate to pay them in an alternative manner. Again, I apologize for the convenience. Sincerely, Caroline. That's why we don't have the original. Caroline sent this out. She was just wanting us to know, and so this was just to let us know. As I see now, it's got her signature. So she must have shown us the original, which she did not sign.
Still waiting for
Mick's
bill for his.
Yes, I'm corrected. I made a note.
We're still waiting for a new quote from Chadwick's that had expired. SEMO electric for fire department is still in here. The letter we read from Mrs. Marcotte is in here. And Lorraine's letter from last week is
that
still in
just
here.
Be filed, yeah.
It's still in here.
Okay.
So, and then I'm just going through.
Yeah.
And then the rest are all these purchase orders that we did tonight.
Okay.
New purchase orders. Move to accept purchase order 1162 to Jeanette Raden.
Just took the minutes.
Yes. For minutes for town meeting, $20 an hour, 6 hours of meeting, and 2 hours of prep and edit for $160.
I'll second. Any discussion?
Yeah. So, where is this money coming out of? That's what I want to know. Because the minutes of the town meeting are supposed to be kept by the town clerk.
Mm-hmm.
So, if she wants to, as she has in the past, when she wasn't there, Ms. Braden took the minutes for her. She paid her out of her salary. If she wants to do that again, that's fine, but that's what it's supposed to happen. It's not, I mean, the clerk is supposed to take the minutes, so contracting out to have someone else do it that we didn't authorize, I mean, it's a little strange to me that this is coming.
We did this, this is, we've been doing this for the last 2 or 3 years.
And my understanding was it was coming out of her salary, that's what she said it was coming out of. This is the first time I remember a check coming out of professional services.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's my take on this. If, you know, what should happen is that this should be part of a budget, you know, and it wasn't part of a budget, and I could see that it wasn't part of a budget, but it should be, and this year, those minutes are, like, supremely important because of the bond implications. And it's no different from what we've been doing the last couple of years, so I guess I'm...
It's different where the money is coming from, though, Suzanne.
I don't know where it came from last year, but I feel quite sure it didn't come out of her salary, out of the town clerk's salary.
That's how it was explained to me the last time it happened.
Well,
if you want to vote on it and do it, that's fine. It's fine. You can pass it, and I'll be happy to sign it, but I'm uncomfortable continuing this practice of when the statute clearly says that the clerk is responsible for taking the minutes.
Exactly.
It's fine if you want to.
Does that mean
farm that out? I mean, she. But
I think you can take it out of her conferences and dues.
Yeah, there's. Yes.
Well, she wouldn't be able to.
I mean, we're responsible for overseeing the court, but we don't do it directly either. We pay somebody else to do it.
But
so
I've asked to do it, and that she doesn't want me to do it.
She doesn't want you to do what?
Overseer of the court. I asked to do welfare. And I asked her to take it off of her plate. And it's her baby, and she likes to do it. But my job is to do it.
And in the end, we do hear the petitions, and we do
correct.
Act
well,
on
I mean, that's kind of interesting. I mean,
yes, I've asked to do it.
Have you spoken to us about this?
Yeah, we were in a meeting.
Mm-hmm. Well, we can revisit this if you'd like.
I would love to, yeah.
All right, in the meantime, we have a motion on the floor. It's okay. I will second this.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? I'll call a vote. All those in favor say aye. Aye. All those opposed, no?
No.
No.
Okay, it doesn't pass. All right.
So
well,
pardon? In the meantime, I mean, Mr. Redden is expecting to be paid, so.
Well, you just said no. I don't know what to tell you. The only
I
way we can
no
send that check
that
is
funding,
to.
Of course.
Well,
you all moved and seconded. I assumed you would at least vote for the motion that you made.
Oh, you motioned
that check. That's the only way that check can get authorized is with a PO. So, and meanwhile, we need those minutes for the things. But I mean, whatever.
We can always do this next week. And
I need the minutes. I do need the minutes this week.
I'll move that we reconsider our action on what was the purchase order number.
Oh, I'm sorry. 1162.
I'm 1162.
Are you moving?
All those in favor?
Are you going? What are you?
I am moving that we reconsider our action on purchase order number 1162. All those in favor, say aye. Right? So we can talk about it again.
I need a second.
You can second it.
All right, I'll second it. All those in favor of reconsidering, say aye.
Aye.
So
if we have to have it for your bond counsel, that's fine.
You're putting it just that you're putting some bigger issues. I think
okay.
That if this is of that much importance, and I understand it, we need to keep this in mind.
We will
for
have
next
a conversation
year.
With it for next
yes.
year, for the next meeting. That's fine.
And we still don't know what line item this is coming out of.
Professional services, or we can put it. What did you suggest?
Put it under that.
Conference and training.
Okay, let's put it there. All right. I'm ready to call the question on this reconsidered purchase order 1162 for $160.
Yeah.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Yeah. All right. So the next year, we have this conversation with the responsibility.
Absolutely, and that's fine. It just, I felt a little, you know, because of our minutes.
You said that we were going to have issues with the...
Well, we can't do a check without, you know, they have to match. All right, next.
Oh, there's one. LaBelle Computer Services, purchase order, I'm sorry, move to accept purchase order 1169. LaBelle Computer Services for 10 hours, Time Block Computer Services for $760. Coming out of professional services.
Actually, no, it comes out of IT.
Sorry. Well, that's what she wrote.
I know. Well, you're reading correctly, let the record show. But it should come out of the IT line. Okay, I'm first and a second. I just will let the board know that this is the 10 block thing. We have a half hour left in the current one. And so this renews and it gets us another 10 hours. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Okay. An anonymous letter from a concerned taxpayer, P.O. Box 309. Board of Selectmen, to whom it may concern, we have heard, you have heard from me in the past, and I remain concerned. I have the opportunity to watch the past several meetings and again learn the police officer is leaving the appointments prematurely. It appears another officer left the cost of taxpayer money with yet no return on our dollar, I believe. This will be the third or fourth consecutive departure with zero return on our investment. Please understand you are managing our tax dollars and seem careless with the reasons for departure. I love our community, but dislike what is happening. You need to somehow, you need at some time follow up as to why the community does not and cannot fill full-time positions or receive qualified candidates for the position advertised.
It's an anonymous letter.
It's an anonymous letter, and there is that, what that chief did send us, that it's hard to find qualified candidates to begin with.
We're not the only police department that's
right. So maybe
so.
It would be good to put that on the website if it's not already, and I don't know if it is or not. I can't remember.
What's on the website?
The letter that chief sent out. It was like a memo.
And also a number of physical requirements. Mental requirements.
Yeah,
right.
Their tests, background checks.
And if they've watched the videos, then they see the chief.
If they can't
said,
meet those requirements, it's
right.
Not that
they're
ask
not
them to leave.
The candidates just aren't as up to par as they used to be.
It's not as attractive a profession for some people.
Exactly. I got a lot of stuff with Boyle and Tanner right here.
They're not going to put that on the website.
An
anonymous letter?
No, not that.
The thing from the chief?
Right.
Sure
I don't know where it is.
They probably did it the first time they got it.
If not, chief has it. Where is he now?
This looks like an authorizing signature for the wetlands permit that's like right there. So I don't know whether it's just a copy or I think I signed this last week, I think. So yeah, I believe it goes with that. So I'll keep this and check with them, but I don't know what they're not asking me to sign, really. But where did you find this? Was it attached?
It was in the file.
Just loose?
It was loose in the file.
I'll keep it there and see.
Do you want me to go to this now?
Yes. Yeah.
This is our Wetlands Bureau application. This is stating that they received it. Quite a bit of information between wetlands and endangered species. One of the things that, as I was reading through this, is the road closures. So I know that when Summersworth did the Maple Street culvert, it was closed for 3 months in the summertime. And this is a tiny little culvert that's only about 6 feet deep. So I think our residents should be prepared for those roads to be completely blocked, because you couldn't go down that road at all for 3 months. So I have a feeling these roads will also be closed for months, because they're much steeper, much wider.
Yeah, well, Hoyle Tanner's working on the design thing,
right.
So we, when they're ready to present them, we can ask them about that.
Exactly, but it says right in here, install traffic detour signage and barriers for road closure.
Yeah.
So
yeah, there will likely be road closures.
Right.
Yes.
And
the good news, I think, the good news is that, you know, they're, you know, one is not going to be stuck. Ways to go around.
Oh yeah, there's plenty of ways to go around.
So, but yeah, I think you're correct. It will be
being dropped off at summer camp and going across to a wedding at the Legion or whatever.
Yeah, all those things.
So
very good. So I'm just curious whether
we should keep them well prepared.
Is, but I'm leery of signing something that I don't even know what I'm signing.
Yes.
Right? I'll find out from Hoyle Tanner what it is. Okay,
you want for that.
I have my own copy, which is not good because it's paper, so please find another home for it.
Yes, I'll put it in our office.
So that's, now those are the Hoyle Tanner invoices. Again, I'd like the board to look at them so that you can get an idea of how we're going with expenses and stuff.
Yes.
Sorry, I've seen them.
Okay, Department of Environmental Services, notice of acceptance of permit application for Land Resource Management, Wetland Bureau. This is just to say that they received them on March 23rd.
So that's
yes. Please note that this letter is not a permit to authorize work to begin.
Fair enough.
So. Legal invoices. You just wanted us to see this.
Yes. Yeah.
And then we might. Board of Tax and Land Appeals, Towood Realty Group versus Town of Rollinsford docket. The Board of Tax and Land Appeals have received a settlement agreement on November 3rd, 2016. Dated March 21st, 2017. So, that's
so
nice
they,
to get that
yes.
quickly.
Right.
So,
is the house on 3rd Street?
Oh, so they settled. So
they settled.
They settled. We probably have already abated this, didn't we? Didn't we do have an abatement, a couple of checks and stuff? So they're a little behind the paywall there.
Yeah.
I think we've already.
When they gave us plenty of notice when the gas station shut down.
That's true.
Jeff's first credit card invoice.
Actually, it is the credit card invoice, I think, so that the only thing is Jeff. So you can see, it's just so the board can see, this is the kind of stuff that we'll be looking at with the credit card.
So
you can see the purchase, you can see the purchaser.
Where he shopped, what he bought.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, well that suffice as we get this.
I like them.
Okay.
And then we'll take a look every week?
Whenever we get them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, once a month, sorry. Oh, please note that you should pay it directly on time because it's 15% interest.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot be late on those. And 25% of cash withdrawals.
We're not doing cash withdrawals. They're
joking.
I'm joking.
So this is just an abatement still back from January that's been sitting in the folder. So Chad's already looked at it.
Is it asking us to do something? to accept it or not?
No, it was just a notification that the landowner has filed an abatement.
Oh, they haven't. It's not their recommendation to abate or not?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
No. Above reference abatement request.
Okay.
So do not hesitate to call me.
All right.
So, and for Department of Transportation and Planning, we're going to sign it.
That's the thing I'm going to work on with Caroline. She didn't ask me to work on it, so.
And you still can't fill it out because you don't have the planning board chair yet.
Okay.
So.
All right.
And Comcast, once again. And DOT, what they're going to be paving this year from last week.
Okay.
And that's it.
Any comments from the public?
Well, I'm, hi.
Patrick.
Hi, Patrick. Carroll, Dover resident.
Great to see you the other day.
Yeah, you as well. Nice tour. I came through and wanted to say hi, but also I have a meeting, I set up a meeting with EPA in Boston on May 25th. We're talking about stuff going on in the state, but one of them is MS4 permits, because we've had a lot of conversations with communities. So I can email Caroline, but if I don't know if the board want to put something together, that maybe concerns or difficulties or costs or just dealing with MS4 permits.
Well, you know, we're there's a workshop that the EPA is putting on that I'm going to, and perhaps other members of our school, we've got a stormwater committee on. I think that's like a week, next Friday, I think. So, we're part of the Seacoast Stormwater Coalition. I mean, I don't know that we have time to do anything like specific about gripes or complaints because we're just not at that level of attention to detail. But one question I do have, which if it's appropriate for you to do some digging around, is whether or not we can waive it. Are we small enough and are we not urban enough so that we can waive it? It was one of the questions. They do have a waiver process. Don't look at me like that. They do have a waiver process. I'm aware of that. And so I was going to ask the Stormwater Committee, someone there wanted to sort of suss out what is involved in that. But not the entire town of Rollinsford is part of, I don't even know what to call it, but comes under the MS4 permit. And they're based on the last census, the 2010 census, I think there's even been a change of urban versus rural. So I just want to make sure, it's not, I'm not trying to avoid, evade, whatever,
yeah.
But I'm also, if there's a way that we can legitimately, doesn't mean we wouldn't work on stormwater, we're working on it now and we've been doing some things, and we will continue to do some things, but the paperwork and the, it's just another thing that we have to worry about.
Yep.
So.
Noted.
So
yeah, it's impacting every community a little bit differently. It's interesting.
It's what?
Every community it's impacting differently. Some communities are putting off development stages they're about to enter for different parts of the city like Dover. So it's interesting how it's impacting every community.
Well, we've done some things. So last year, we formed a stormwater committee.
Yep.
We've been going to the Seacoast Stormwater Coalition once a month at the Dover posts. We started the notice of intent, the permit, and last year we hired Scott McGlynn, and he's now formed a little company to work on these kinds of things, and so he evaluated our outfalls and our catch basins and stuff. So we're building up some data on that sort of thing.
Yep.
His test came out okay. We've hired him to do checks again this year. We're putting in check dams at the site of erosion in Stockdale Circle, right before it goes down into Partridge Lane culvert, there's erosion that's going on. We're not sure exactly where it's coming from, so we're gonna put some check dams to see if we can figure it out. But a lot of that silt is going right down to the Legion. I'm not pointing the right way, but wherever it is. You can see where the outfall is there's a tree growing now where some of the silt and whatever has just kind of gone into the river. So those are some of the things that we've been working on.
All right.
Anything else from the public? Then, can valid right. Okay, we're done. Don't go away. I want to talk to you, Patrick.
So
we'll just add this. It's not really, there is a request for a recount for SB2. And I think the clerk is scheduling it for Sunday.
Sunday at 9 a.m.
This coming Sunday at 9 a.m. That's all I know.
Can I ask a question about that? If the voting machines are 99.9997% accurate and a hand count is significantly less accurate than that, how does that work in terms of determining? I mean,
we have to keep counting over and over and over and over and over again.
Yeah.
It's kind of what we had to do for a budget committee recount last year. You know, and people don't come up to the same totals twice in a row.
Mm-hmm.
I have no other way to, we've been asked to, you know, it's a request, and so we have to fulfill it.
Yeah.
As far as I know, there was only one ballot that was not counted by the vote counting machine. And I think they counted it as a vote for SB2, so even with that one, it didn't pass. But again, it was a request, so we're going to honor the request.
Well, I know you have to honor it. It's fascinating to me that that would be considered more valid than the machine.
Actually, when, it had nothing to do with our count, but when Alyssa asked for a recount in November, we found out that Ward 4 in Summersworth was off by 50 counts. 50.
But I wonder about, human error. It's just interesting to me.
Yeah.
All right, we are adjourned. We are just kind of
sorry.
Yeah.
So. That is confirmed.
Confirmed. No, it's a suggested time. I don't know. It's the town clerk and the moderator who are, I think.
And the question was asked whether the select board was available. And I think I'm the only one that responded to the email.
No, I responded. I said it was.
Okay. The majority of us would be there.
Yep. Okay, we've been done. We're just.